Welcome to Martinsville, Virginia, and Martinsville Speedway for the Camping World Truck Series Kroger 250. It is the seldom used Monday race for the Camping World Truck Series, and let's begin with our pre-race ceremonies. We go down trackside.
Race fans, at this time, would you please rise and remove your hats for today's invocation and the singing of our national anthem. For today's invocation from Raceway Ministries, Michael Harrison.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this day that you've given us, for this wonderful weather. And we want to pray for these drivers and these race teams that you would continue to give protection, that you would give them a great day and just continue to watch over everything that happens here on the Martinsville Speedway. Thank you for the opportunity to be watching this race. And we ask that you continue to bless this sport, and thank you for giving it to us. And God, we thank you for what you're doing around us, for your son, Jesus. We want to honor him today. We also want to thank you for giving us hope. In this economy, again, we ask that you would bless our community and bless our nation. For it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
And now for today's national anthem from the Martinsville High School Band, Kevin Lewis.
Kevin Lewis with a great rendition of our national anthem. As the drivers are getting ready, they will be climbing into the race trucks as we're about to go racing with the Camping World Truck Series on Monday. And welcome back to the paperclip we call Martinsville Speedway. Again, we're running this race on Monday because Saturday the rains came and stopped the running of the Kroger 250. Today, 55 degrees. It's a bit cooler. The breeze is blowing down the backstretch, so shouldn't be too much of a hindrance on any of the drivers, but a little bit cooler day than what they were expecting. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Martinsville Speedway. Once again, I'm Rick Allen alongside Phil Parsons and Michael Waltrip. Now, Phil, we were down in the garage earlier on the pit road talking to different crew chiefs. What do you think the best strategy that came out of that discussion was?
Well, if I talk to 22 crew chiefs, I got 22 different strategies. But, you know, they have to think about last year, this race. Dennis Setzer won this race by never changing tires. He put fuel in around lap 70, went the rest of the way, ran his fastest lap around lap 200. We've got a different right side tire here. So all the crew chiefs down there are wondering whether they should stop once, they should stop twice. And for the first time in 9 years, Michael, these guys are running after the cup race. The track is full of rubber. You put 500 laps of that rubber down yesterday. What are they going to face today that they typically don't earlier in the weekend?
The track is good. I just really think the track is coming around to where these guys are going to be able to race really hard today. You can go down low. You can slide up and run in the middle up to the high lane. The crew chiefs yesterday were watching, trying to figure out how these tires would fall off, what would happen to the cup cars when they ran on these tires for the first time. So there's more knowledge than they would have had, but they're still confused because we have all these pit road rules. And Martinsville's a track where you got to you got to get after them. You got to get in there and jam. And if you make a mistake, you better make it early, because this race is short and you can't overcome it if you make one much later than say the first 30 laps or so.
Right, and you were talking about strategies and different things. Obviously, the pit road rules changed a bit in the Camping World Truck Series, and they can't put tires and add fuel on the same pit stop. Now, yesterday, Kyle Busch ran in this race. Well, he would have had to have changed tires and put fuel, and he had a tough day. Let's take a look back at this race.
Well, he just gets to wheel hopping, Phil, when he gets down into turn three, and poor Scott Speed, he's just making room for Kyle Busch, but he didn't quite make enough. I don't know if there was the ability to make enough room right there.
There you see him melting the bead on the right front tire, which typically happens at Martinsville. You use so much brake, you get so much brake heat, and that will actually melt the bead on the tire.
Take a look at our Camping World Truck Series points through three races. Kyle Busch is our point leader, but the problem is, well, Todd Bodine's right there, and we're expecting Todd to run the entire season. We're not expecting Kyle to run the entire season.
What a great battle we're going to have, though, as these people try to figure out how they're going to get sponsorship to go race, whether Kyle shows up or not. You got some guys that are going to pounce. They're ready to take that point lead if possible.
Our first short track race of the season. Let's fire the engines.
And now, race fans, for the most famous words in motorsports from Kroger Store, number 407, Michael Moser.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
The engines are fired back up. Again, the last time they were running competitively on the track, Saturday, and it's already Monday. We'll be back for the green flag right after this. Martinsville, Virginia, the paperclip-shaped half mile with its unique hot dogs and its unique brand of racing. Short track racing, Martinsville Speedway. Well, we don't just expect bumping and banging. It's almost welcome when we come to Martinsville. You've got to move somebody out of the way if you want to get by. We take a look at our starting grid. Rick Crawford with his sixth career pole and his 301st career start. And Shane Sieg, a career best start for him on the outside of row one.
Got a couple former champions back in row number two, Johnny Benson and Ron Hornaday. They battled for that championship right down to the last race, the last lap last year.
Rounding out the top 10 there, Timothy Peters. This has been a real good story this year. They came to Daytona with limited funds. They've been able to string it together to Martinsville. Now they have sponsorship for Kansas and beyond. I'm liking what this Timothy Peters kid and this team are doing.
Kyle Busch all the way back there starting 11th in row number six. So he's going to have to work his way through a very tight track.
Inside row number 11, Stacy Compton had a very fast truck in practice. Did not get the qualifying effort that he had hoped for, so he's got a little bit of work cut out for him.
Back on the inside of row 15, Ricky Carmichael, two-wheel star, trying to adapt to the four wheels. Says he likes his truck, feels real good about today.
Let's see if we can make contact with Kevin Harvick. Hey, Kevin Harvick, Phil Parsons, you got a copy?
Hey, Phil.
Kevin, you got 500 laps under your belt yesterday. A little bit of uncharted territory for you guys racing after all that rubber's put down. You make any changes to the truck this morning?
Yeah, we changed our truck a little bit air pressure-wise. Didn't want to get too far out of bounds, but a little bit concerned about that. Hopefully we make the right adjustments.
We talk a lot about the strategy here. We know this race was won last year by somebody not changing tires. Goodyear changed that right side tire. Do you anticipate some tire changes?
I think everybody's going to change tires. Benson beat myself and Hornaday with tires, and I think these wear out a little faster. So hopefully we do the right things with our Bounty Chevrolet. Just want to thank everybody from Kroger and Bounty for helping us out.
Well, that's a great-looking truck, buddy. Have a good run, Kevin.
Phil.
Let's head down to pit road, and we'll start with Chris DeBoda.
Well, Rick, where would Colin Brown be if he wasn't in Martinsville? He would be in the Caribbean. No, seriously, he had a cruise scheduled with his brother Travis. He had to call him and give him the bad news. Travis said, dude, I'm in college. It's spring break. I'm locked out of my dorm. So where is Travis? Well, today, he is a race fan. Travis drove all the way from Indiana to sit in the stands. There he is waving, watching his brother Colin. Hey, Adam, who needs St. Martin when you have Martinsville?
Oh, you can't beat Martinsville on a Monday. And Johnny Benson, the defending series champ, off to a tough start in 2009. It took him three races to get his first top 10 finish of the year. But today he returns to the scene of his last victory. He led 46 laps and won here last October. And today in a new truck, he's hoping to rekindle some of that Martinsville magic. Driver one starting in P3, guys.
Thank you so much, Double A. Now, who would you say has the advantage coming into a racetrack that has the rubber down on it? Are you going to give the nod to, say, a Cup regular or maybe a truck veteran?
I like Harvick. You know, he learned a lot yesterday, had a solid car, understands what these tires are going to do somewhat. You know, he talked about his strategy, making the right decisions there. He knows what the track, how it's going to rubber up. And, Phil, that'll happen. Right now, you see down in the corners, it's just concrete. But there'll be some rubber that actually lays down on top of that concrete that these guys will have to navigate around. So Harvick understands all that. I think he's got the truck to beat today.
And plus, he had a great truck on Friday during the Truck Series practices. You can see some of that rubber building up already down there, and that's from yesterday.
Take a look at our race analysis. Again, this is a 250-lap race, 131 miles. So pit strategy comes into play here more than ever. The pit window, 140 to 150, that's again for fuel, though.
Yeah, that's for fuel. And some of the guys, you know, are talking about not wanting to lose any track position. So they may come in on the first round of pit stops, put tires on, not bother to come back in to put fuel on, wait to do that till the next caution flag.
Yeah, we talked about the new pit road rules. You can't do both on the same right. stop. You can get some gas or you can get some tires. I like the way that's going to play out here at Martinsville, Phil, because gas isn't that important. You know, you can go a long way on your gas, and tires sometimes need to be played. You need to have them on later in the race. So maybe you do just come and get you some gas, or you get you some tires, and then you figure out how you're going to play the game. It's a curveball that Harvick was talking about. Do we play the right strategy? Well, we're all flying by the seat of our pants on this deal. We don't really know what the right strategy is, but we're getting ready to find out.
We're about to definitely get to the seat of our pants at the start of this one as Rick Crawford and Shane Sieg are bringing the field through 3 and 4, about to get underway with the Kroger 250 racing on Monday in Martinsville. Green flag in the air. Problems early on with Shane Sieg. He has Ron Hornaday all over the back bumper of him.
That could be problems for Hornaday. He hit the back of that 15 truck hard. If he caved that grill in or that nose in, that could cause some heating problems for that truck. You can see, Phil, the front end of his truck has been up.
He does have a little bit of damage, and these guys put as much tape on there as they can physically put on there for aerodynamic reasons. And if that opening is compromised at all, that could cause him some heating problems.
Still seeing some two wide racing back there as they start to file out in front.
These guys are all over each other. Harvick was on the inside of Brown, and Colin didn't know he was there, and Harvick left his nose in just enough to open a hole. Then we saw Kyle Busch three wide right behind those guys.
Energizer Bunny on the hood of Matt Kraft in that 88 Chevrolet just behind this Conway Freight of Colin Brown. Six truck, as Chris mentioned, his brother on hand to watch.
Battle for third right there, Shane Sieg. Remember, he was very slow on the start. Hornaday's going to look to the inside. I don't think Hornaday's going to wait for long behind that 15 truck.
Well, he's not going to be able to wait for long because that number two truck is going to drive right up to him, and that's his boss. He's going to say, boss, I got to go. I need to make some room.
Right now, Shane staying right on the bottom of the racetrack. Remember, that's a teammate to Kyle Busch. Great qualifying effort for Shane. His career best on the outside of the front row, but Ron Hornaday's not caring about any of that right now.
And I'm impressed with Shane. He's keeping up a good pace, but he just can't hold off Hornaday. You can see down to the inside Hornaday goes. Harvick tried to get in that hole that his teammate opened up but couldn't quite pull it off. Look at the front of that 33 truck, Phil. Could that cause problems?
It looks like it could. The very bottom of that grill, and that's where they take a lot of that air in. That could cause some serious heating problems. Krista, what's going on with Shane Sieg?
Well, Shane Sieg definitely has some damage to that the left side of that truck. Obviously, Hornaday getting in there. He's just trying to gain some confidence. Richie Waters said this is so important, the qualifying effort starting second, and they have a brand new sponsor, Woodard Pools, on the truck for the first time. Shane Sieg just trying to stay up front.
Well, right now, he's trying to stay in front of the two of Kevin Harvick, who's making his way to the inside. Let's see. Nope, Shane closes the door once again on Kevin Harvick.
You know, Harvick raced 500 laps yesterday. We talked about that. This is 250 laps. You have to double your intensity. You got to get it done in a hurry here in the trucks.
This is a sprint for Kevin Harvick today.
And look at the gap in front of Shane Sieg. Kevin's got a lot of patience, but he's not going to stay there long knowing that those guys in front of Shane Sieg are driving away.
can't tell you how hard to do what the two just did. Did you see him? He made that corner with his nose all the way up underneath the back of the 15 truck. He couldn't see where he was going. He was just trusting that the 15 truck would keep up some sort of pace. Now he's down on the inside.
Got the preferred line now right up next to the curb. Able to get by that 15. Now you see Matt Crafton trying to move Shane Sieg out of the way and take that position away once again. And up front, it is a battle for the lead. Rick Crawford and Johnny Benson.
Shane Sieg is continuing to lose some spots right side of your screen. There's Timothy Peters, the 17 truck.
Man, once it starts, Phil, it's just really, really hard to. You can see him cutting down in front of his teammate. His teammate's Kyle Busch, though, isn't he? He's not going to take too kindly to that.
And there's nowhere to hide at this racetrack.
No.
If you're off the pace at all, you there is absolutely nowhere to hide.
Colin Brown's making the move on the outside. Ryan Scott in that 16.
If you start last, you can hide for a little while, and then the leaders will be right there. But he started right up front.
More contact here. It's just a matter of time for Shane Sieg, it looks like.
There's Mac Pappas, the Geico Toyota, on the inside.
Now check this out. Peters goes and Shane says, I can just cut in front of my teammate, I think. Think again,
maybe
buddy.
Not.
Yeah, see, that's a situation where the spotter needs to say, hey, you've got two trucks coming. Make sure you leave room for that second truck, whether it's your teammate or not.
So, again, Shane Sieg starting on the outside of row number one in that number two position. Smoke coming out of the 13, it looks like, of that fun sand. And I believe he's also got he's carrying somebody else on that truck.
Yeah, Rodney Atkins. He's got him on the hood and also on the bed of that truck. But maybe a little left front tire. Caution is out now.
It looks like oil there, Phil.
It did. He had some damage to that fender.
Yeah, he's got oil. He's got an oil leak.
It smells like oil, that's for sure.
Have you heard that new song of Rodney Atkins, America?
I have not.
Oh,
is it good?
Yeah, real good song. You want me to sing it a little or no?
No, I don't think
rather
so.
Not. Lap 13, the first caution comes out for truck number 13 and Johnny Sauter. Here's another look at the start of this race.
Rick Crawford right on the button. Shane Sieg just doesn't go, and then it looks like he almost missed a gear.
I'd say he did, and that sort of set the tone for Shane Sieg's first 20 laps or so. He started getting hit on the start and hadn't quit getting hit yet.
Watch him stack up behind him. Ron Hornaday was going because he had started to go, and then all of a sudden looked like he missed a gear. Pretty significant contact.
Yeah, that makes me nervous about the front of that truck. But if it was overheating, we would have seen some water shooting out of the front of it. So I guess he's fine, but that's a lot of contact.
Green flag flying for pit row. That means that's open. They're doing a little work on the 13. We'll be right back. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Camping World, the official RV and outdoor retailer of NASCAR, and by Cheez-It, the big cheese.
That gopher's happy.
Digger.
You know why I think he's so happy? Because he gets to get out of that hole now. David Hill
on
introduced
Monday
him to the world, and now the gopher's out and about. And he's got a marketing plan behind him.
he's got commercials and cartoons
plus
and all sorts of things.
If you're a gopher,
he's almost as big as your brother now.
If you're a gopher and you're holding Cheez-Its, what else could you have? I mean, how good? Life couldn't be any better.
Well, we stay with wildlife.
Aflac!
We go from the gopher to the duck. Aflac, our trivia question. How many truck races have been run on Monday?
I know, but don't say anything. We're going to give the answer later, right?
Well, you know, so I can't say anything because I don't.
You don't know how many truck races have been run on Monday. Well, if you don't, stick around. Obviously, we will give you the answer to that question. I'll just tell you, it hasn't been done very often. Field lining back up as we're getting ready to restart. Before that, let's head down to Adam Alexander.
And why don't we talk about Kevin Harvick, who has now got 19 laps under green on this truck, which was brand new when the weekend started. Hadn't turned a lap before practice here on Friday. He started sixth up to fourth. The report from the Deuce, a little bit tight, and I can definitely see the truck behind me getting bigger and bigger. That would be Matt Crafton.
Matt Crafton used to drive for Kevin Harvick.
He did. Sure did. When the first time Kevin had a full-time Truck Series team, Matt was his driver.
You know, the front end of that, too, looked somewhat similar to the front end of the 33. I mean, he's got some damage to the front end of his truck.
I'm telling you,
well,
he came through 3 and 4 with his nose all the way underneath the back of that 15 truck. And I don't see how I've done this a little bit. I don't see how Harvick could see where he was going. I mean, you got to have some
visual, and he didn't have it. He just was trusting the 15 was going in the right direction, and Kevin was thinking he could get there faster.
Just following Matt Crafton. He mentioned truck looking a little bit bigger in the rearview mirror. We'll be right back with more Racing on Speed. Still under caution, our first caution of the day was Johnny Sauter that spilled a little oil on the racetrack. You can learn everything that's going on this racetrack if you want to tune in and join the SpeedTV.com chat with Tom Jensen. Live chat going on right now, so if you got your computer close by, SpeedTV.com and Tom Jensen. Talk racing. Coming back to the green flag, it's Rick Crawford leading Johnny Benson, our series defending series champion. And back to green we are in the Kroger 250.
See, Hornaday tried to make a run on Johnny Benson, but the lap truck there on the inside prevented him from doing so, but he's not going to prevent it now. He's under him off too.
Caution back out early. It's the six of Colin Brown not looking good right now.
That's a tire rub there. He's hit something on the restart, you can see.
Probably a chain reaction kind of deal here. See if we can take a look at what happened to Colin Brown and that Conway Ford.
Splitters folded completely underneath the front tire.
Oh, wow.
He's going to get into the inside wall. I wonder if he.
I think maybe he locked
the brakes up, maybe?
He might have let off and tried to get on the inside of the five because of a chain reaction, like you said, Phil, and he turned the wheel too hard. Wow, that thing hit hard.
Boy, it really did. And it almost hit the five of Mike Skinner. See if we can take a look from Todd Bodine's onboard. The wheeling on.
Yeah, he was going to hit. You know, it's a chain reaction, like you said. He was going to run in the back of the five, tried to avoid the five, and hit the darn wall.
Yeah. Here's Colin right here. You see him. He had to dive to the inside to avoid running in the back of Mike Skinner, but unfortunately, at the same time, braking extremely hard, and the thing just turned left on him.
That was unfortunate because you have to be on your toes on these restarts and understand that for the first corner or two, first time you dive into one and three, anything could happen. So you got to leave yourself a little bit of room to make sure if something does go haywire, you can overcome it. He wasn't able to do that.
Second caution comes out. Colin Brown on the restart gets into the inside wall. We'll be right back. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Budweiser. Reach for the perfect balance of flavor and refreshment. Budweiser, the great American lager. Behind the wall is Colin Brown. He put some oil on the racetrack. They're trying to clean that up. Krista, what's going on with that team?
They are thrashing down here right now, obviously trying to get all the front fenders off the wheels. In fact, the truck is actually getting, I guess, what you'd call a haircut. I mean, they're completely cutting the front fenders off the wheels. But the bigger problem, they crushed in the radiator. They brought the truck behind the wall so they could replace the radiator. And Mike Beam, the crew chief, saying, Colin, I think you wheel hopped it. Colin said, yeah, I did not brake that much deeper than I normally do.
Sometimes under the caution flag, though, you have a situation where the brakes cool off a little bit and they may grab just a tick more than they would have when they were already up to temperature.
And we're talking hair, you know, just a difference in a hair. How much harder you brake can make that truck do some different things. And I promise you, when he got down to turn one, Skinner stopped a little bit sooner than he thought he was. So he reacted quicker than he meant to, and that's what got him out of whack.
Well, let's answer the question we had earlier talking about Monday races. The question was, how many truck races have been run on Monday? I'm going to let you throw out a guess.
I'm going to guess, if that duck would be quiet.
one. Oh, three. Well, counting this time.
This is three.
Counting this
today.
Well, I meant
today.
Two.
Yeah.
Counting this.
That's
one.
Why you said one, of course.
I meant one before this one, so two, but it really was two, so I was wrong either way.
It's actually three, and amazingly enough, they've all been run right at this racetrack.
Every one of them right here at Martinsville, the last time in 2000. So that's the last time 9 years ago that the Truck Series raced after the Cup Series on a given weekend.
And that's another unique situation, obviously, that these drivers are going to have to deal with. Ron Hornaday trying to battle up there for the lead. Krista, what's happening with that team?
Well, just a quick little note. We talked about the contact with Shane Sieg right off the bat. Shane Sieg did miss a shift. That's why Ron Hornaday got into him. But as we see the radiator getting replaced back here behind the wall in the six, it reminds me that Rick Wren just came on the radio to Ron Hornaday and said, Ron, try not to run into anybody else. The damage could cause overheating.
Like, Ryan didn't know that.
Yeah.
I'm glad Rickren told him that, because I'm sure he was thinking he was just going to keep running into people.
Well, and he will. Part of his plan today is to run into more people, I promise you that. Until he's out front, he's going to run into people until he gets there. So he'll take that information and file it somewhere, but I'm not so sure he's going to listen to it.
Well, this weekend, NASCAR moves to Texas, and our coverage begins on Friday with Sprint Cup Series practice on speed, then Sprint Cup Series qualifying. On Saturday, it's two sessions of Sprint Cup Series practice on speed, and Sunday begins with NASCAR Race Day on speed, and then it's Sprint Cup Series racing on Fox, followed by NASCAR Victory Lane on speed. Our coverage of NASCAR continues next weekend across the Fox networks.
It's a bit of an odd schedule next week at Texas. The nationwide cars do all their practice and qualifying on Thursday, and then their garage is closed on Friday. It opens up for the Sprint Cup Series, and they do all their practicing and qualifying.
And I'm going to be running down there in Texas in the Aaron's Dream Machine.
That's right.
So I get to learn about all that scheduling you're talking about.
I'll let you know.
Yeah, thanks. Adam, what's going on?
Why don't we talk about Mike Skinner? This guy knows what it's like to be successful here. He's led more laps at this racetrack in a truck than any other driver. Three times he's gone to victory lane, but a rough start today. He's got some damage you can see. Got shoved into the outside lane at the start. He went from 9th to 13th, and he's been status quo since then. But he feels good about the truck. We'll keep our eye on the 5 and the progress he can make throughout the afternoon.
Very cosmetic damage there on the 5.
We're coming to the green, but these crew chiefs, their brains are spinning down there, Phil. They just had a significant long caution period here. That'll change their strategy a little bit, won't it?
Absolutely. This race averages over 80 laps of caution in the last 5 years.
Green flag back in the air. Rick Crawford leads the field to the start-finish line. Johnny Benson behind him, then Ron Hornaday. Kevin Harvick and Matt Crafton are your top 5.
Boy, Rick really caught a break beating Johnny Sauter down there to turn number 1. And you can see right now he's got Johnny Sauter pinned in between himself and the second place trucker, Johnny Benson. Remember now, Johnny is 11 laps down now, Johnny Sauter in that 13 truck after extensive repairs on pit road.
And when you're the one truck of Johnny Benson, you're not going to wait around long for a guy 11 laps down to get out of your way so you can get after the leader. You know, when this first caution flew, the truck of Johnny Benson was all over our leader, Rick Crawford. Okay. So Johnny knows he's fast, and he's not going to mess with that lap truck long.
Single file line. You see some of the slower lap traffic they're going to work around now. But again, Johnny Benson 11 laps down just in front of Johnny, or Johnny Sauter 11 laps down in front of Johnny Benson, who's running second. So now Johnny Benson obviously would be frustrated having to deal with a lap truck.
He's totally frustrated.
Yeah, and it's only going to get worse. And so Johnny Benson won't mess around long. I'm telling you, he'll get into the back of that 13 truck and get him out of his way. And Johnny Benson's probably thinking, where the heck did he come from anyway? He come flying up the inside right at the last minute.
Well, right now, Johnny's on the radio saying, where's this 13? How many laps is he down? And when Tripp Bruce tells him he's 11 laps down, Johnny's going to say, why is he not getting out of my way?
Had a good run on him there through 3 and 4, but now Sauter put a little distance between him and the front bumper of Johnny Benson.
Johnny Benson was the man last year here. Looks like he's got a good truck today too, Phil.
Yeah, he won this race in the fall, the 200 lap race, and was running second on the last lap and got run into by Kyle Busch and got turned around in the spring race.
Kevin Harvick back there in the 4th spot. He was a little disappointed in his qualifying effort, because it was raining more or less when he was on the racetrack.
I talked to him right after that. He was so glad that they were able to qualify, because if not, if they would have rained out the tail end of qualifying and not got it done, Kevin would have started way, way back, because that truck does not run all the races and did not run all the races last year. So he's awfully glad to get what he got, which was a 6th place starting run.
Adam, how's Johnny Benson doing back there?
You know, we know that Johnny Benson is a patient guy, but he has taken patience to a whole new level in this situation. He has said nothing about Johnny Sauter, who is 11 laps down in front of him, keeping him from racing Rick Crawford for the lead. And perhaps the reason why, maybe more concerned with the guy behind him than the one in front of him.
Well, he's over any hostility he had, because Sauter's been able to pull away from him. So he's not frustrated at all now with Johnny Sauter. He's thinking, my truck needs to be better. If I'm going to go up there and race with Crawford, I got to improve my truck. He's also would like to think that since he sees Sauter has some speed, that he could get up there and get at least behind him. So if Sauter's able to work his way around the leader and get one of those 11 laps back, Johnny be in position to take the lead away from Crawford when Sauter goes by.
And Johnny Benson running second, chasing that 14 of Rick Crawford. Krista.
That's right, Rick. Rick Crawford, I talked with his crew chief, Cowboy Starlin, this morning, and Cowboy said lap 60 is kind of that magic number, playing the math game. That's where they wanted to get before they planned on coming in. Cowboy said he is so nervous this morning. I said, why? You're on the pole. He said, exactly. I don't want to do anything to screw it up.
I'll tell you what, Johnny Sauter might be screwing it up here pretty soon. He got right on the back bumper of Crawford, our leader.
He's got a very good truck. And when we were talking about Johnny Benson being frustrated with Johnny Sauter, well, Johnny's also up here. He knows he's 11 laps down, but he knows he has a good truck. And he wants to show people that he has a good truck.
And he also wants to get a lap back, because a lap might mean a position later in the day. So race car drivers generally, when you have a truck as fast as Sauter's, thinks I can get all 11 of these laps back and have a chance to get a good finish out of this deal. And here he goes. He's getting one of them back right now.
Yeah, take a look at that. Now, just as we were cutting away, you could see the tire smoke. It looked like Rick Crawford locked the front tires up a little bit on that truck, and it allowed Johnny Sauter to make the pass.
Yeah, he may have got in that corner just a little bit too hot, and it definitely locked that left front up. I was watching the cup race yesterday, standing down in turn number three, and it's amazing how many. Watch this now. Watch that left front tire on that 14 truck. You see it?
Yeah.
The letter stopped moving. That's because it's locked up, and then Johnny makes a little bit of contact, which I'm sure, even though Rick got in the corner too hot, locked the brakes up, he's still not going to appreciate a truck 11 laps down getting it in the back of him. Another view of it there on the right side of your screen. Now they're really stacked up. You've got Johnny Benson all over the rear bumper of that 14. And then look at Hornaday, looks to the inside.
There comes Hornaday battling for second.
Oh, he
gets into the side of him. And Hornaday is going to spin Johnny Benson around.
That was a situation where Ron didn't quite have enough room. And he bounced off the curb. He was down there. He committed to the inside, but he bounced off the curb. And when he did, it shot him out into the one truck of Johnny Benson and turned him around.
We just mentioned the way this race ended a year ago with Kyle Busch knocking Johnny Benson out of the way. And this is very similar.
Look, Ron hits the curb, like you said, Phil, and it knocks him up into the side of the one truck of Johnny Benson. Ron hits the curb or not, Johnny still don't feel very good about him spinning him out.
That's right. You could see when he hit the curb, then it shot that truck up 2 or 3 feet, and that was just enough to make contact with Johnny.
Johnny left him just enough room to get in there, but he didn't leave him any room for an error. And I think maybe Hornaday would have rubbed Johnny, and Johnny wouldn't have spun had he not hit that curb.
I think
but when
so
he
too.
Hit the curb, he jumped into the side of Johnny Benson, and around Johnny went.
Adam, you were talking about patience earlier. Maybe those are gone now, that patience?
What's amazing to me is the fact that Benson gets spun out on a short track and only loses 6 positions. He was running second when he got popped by Hornaday. Right now, scored in the 8th position. And since they really didn't lose much as far as track position is concerned, they elected to leave him on track. The tires were good, and they didn't want to pit here. They are not yet where they want to be as far as their pit window is concerned.
I think we can say safely that these guys are going to try to pit just one time for tires today. If they're going to try to do it twice, you'd probably seen some guys put them on now. And maybe that is Todd Bodine's strategy, but I'd say Crawford, Hornaday, those guys are looking at one pit stop.
Yeah, I think so too.
For tires, they obviously have to make two. They'll need a little bit of gas too. This will be our first chance to see what maybe these guys are thinking. You got Todd Bodine getting 4 tires. He'll probably come in and get gas and be done pitting, Phil?
I would think so, because there's so few trucks behind him right now. He might as well come on in and get his fuel. Then he knows, depends on how the race plays out, he knows that he can stay out if he wants to. And there he is coming right back to pit road following David Starr into the Zachary Toyota.
Again, the rules in the Camping World Truck Series, you cannot put fuel into the truck and change tires on the same pit stop. So they have to come back around again. He did tires on the first stop, and now they're going to do fuel on this stop.
Now, you know, yesterday we talked about this new tire and how it falls off a little bit more than the old. Yesterday we saw cars be able to run fast times late on their tires. So I like what Todd Bodine's doing right here. I like this strategy. He had to mix it up. He qualified bad. He had to mix it up a little bit, get on a different page, and see if he can make something happen, and that's what this team's trying to do.
Todd Bodine was running 13th, first truck to pit, and they've topped it off with fuel, and back onto the racetrack he will go. We saw two different strategies, differing strategies, in the fact that Todd Bodine put tires on his first stop and then came back in for fuel. The 24 did just the opposite.
Yeah, and I think that's wrong. I think you need to, whatever's going to take the longest, you need to do the first time. And that's what Todd Bodine did. And now he came out several trucks ahead of the 24 of David Starr.
Guess who's going to come back up and have some more fun with his sand?
Johnny Sauter.
He got one back.
Yeah.
Heck, I can get another one, I believe. And Rick Crawford's thinking, why'd you hit me? Don't do that again.
Rick Crawford still out in front of this field. He's the only one who has led this race. All 50 laps that we have run.
Remember, Rick's a former winner here. He won here back in 2004. He led 82 laps in that win.
I believe if I was Hornaday, I'd get behind that 13. I think, yeah, that's exactly right. 13 got a jump on Rick Crawford, opened the door. Here comes Hornaday.
Hornaday trying to take the preferred line right along the curb, but
wow.
Crawford powers out of turn two and is able to close the door on it.
That was big right there. Dove down in the corner and held off Hornaday.
Look, it's contact right behind this group right at start finish line. Terry Cook on the inside, Johnny Benson on the outside.
Benson's gone around once already, and it looks like a tight situation there for Terry Cook and Johnny Benson.
Do a little bit of a block on Terry down the straightaway to let him know that he did not want him to get to the inside of him.
Sometimes a block is followed by somebody saying, don't be blocking me, and a pound into the tailgate.
I'm going to say, if we're going to continue to use football terms, we call that punting here pretty soon, too. They might punt someone out of the way.
I think Ron punted Johnny out of the way. Johnny will remember that, too.
Got a bit of a gap behind Kevin Harvick, back to Matt Crafton, and Matt's running fourth. Kyle Busch, the 51, now has made his way up to the fifth spot, right behind that 88 of Matt Crafton. Let's take a look back at the restart Kyle Busch had here. He was behind Timothy Peters. Watch now. You see, obviously, the 51 truck of Kyle Busch. They're going to get started here. See, Timothy Peters have to back off. Kyle had the momentum, just drove to the inside and took over that fifth spot.
NASCAR doesn't allow you to lay back on a restart. You can't leave two or three truck lengths between you and the truck ahead of you to try to anticipate the start and be able to jump like Kyle Busch did. Kyle was a truck length behind Timothy Peters, but then there was a chain reaction in front of Timothy, made him roll out of the gas, and it gave Kyle the perfect gap to be able to open up and get his get a position off Timothy Peters.
And just behind Timothy Peters is that one of Johnny Benson. Sounds like there might be some problems, Adam.
There may be, Rick. Johnny just came on the radio and said, I feel like I've got a tire going down on the left side, in particular the left rear. His crew chief Trip Roos said it looks fine, and then Johnny just came back on the radio and said it seems to be calming down. He rides in the seventh position.
Didn't we have Johnny thinking the same thing last fall here when he was dominating the race? Somebody got into the left rear corner of his truck and he's like, I know my tire's going flat. Now the same thing's happened to him again. Timothy Peters on the inside of Crafton trying to get the spot that Kyle Busch opened up for him. And yes, Peters will dive inside of Crafton.
Kyle took over the fourth spot. Now Timothy Peters is going to drive by to take fifth. I'm telling you, I'm seeing some smoke out of that 17 truck of Timothy Peters.
A little bit of damage, cosmetic.
Look at Terry Cook go to the outside of Johnny Benson.
Terry Cook trying to make the pass on the high side of the racetrack.
Yeah, there is some smoke coming out of the 17, and that's a shame. What a truck he's got this weekend. He's been fast in all the practices.
Well, Terry trying to hang in on the outside, wasn't quite able to do it. Now he's going to try to duck over in front of that five of Mike Skinner. Did not do it in time. Allows Mike to get to the inside in that bad boy Morris Toyota. Up in front of him.
Right behind these guys. See Terry Cook on the outside is Dennis Setzer. He's driving that 8 truck. He's into the top 10. He won this race a year ago, knows exactly how to do it.
And he's won 3 times here. I'm telling you, Dennis could drive the pace truck. Oh, Brent Raymer is around over in turn number 4.
So that brings out. We're going to come in and work on some more.
Our fourth caution of the day has come out. This time on lap 63.
It's only been about 13 laps since those guys came down pit road. Todd Bodine, David Starr in that group.
Is it time for the leaders to do their pitting and get it over with?
We're getting a little closer to some of the strategies that we heard on pit road where they said, you know, around 60 to 70 laps, I think we can come in, put fuel in it, and then potentially make it to the end of this race.
There's a replay right there. Brent Raymer had a little help. Look, maybe Chris Fontaine. The 84 truck got into the back of them. Pit road is open. Most of the leaders stayed out. Brian Scott, the 16 truck, is the first one to come down pit road. Adam.
And let's talk about Kevin Harvick, who will come down and change tires on his first opportunity on the pit lane. Rubber out of the left rear to help what is a tight handling condition. Krista.
Kyle Kyle Busch coming in for his first pit stop. He said his truck is just a little bit tight, actually tight in the center, on the verge of being loose off. A track bar adjustment is the call for Kyle Busch.
Going to do four tires for Kyle Busch.
And I say these trucks come right back in and get gas. They're done, which I like this strategy.
I'm going to be interested. I was talking to Kevin Harvick Saturday, and he said he thought he was going to come in, put tires on the first time he came in, then wait to the next time to come in to put fuel in it, because he may be just a hair out of the window right now if this race gets a long green flag run.
That 14 of Rick Crawford stayed on the track. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Kroger 250 for the Camping World Truck Series from Martinsville Speedway on the Monday edition. It's Rick Crawford still out in front.
Rick Crawford got beat on the restart by the 13 last time. Let's see if he changes it up a little bit. Uh-oh.
Decided to wave this off.
No restart.
He's not going to beat him this time.
Nope.
They're going to wave it off. The 07 truck, I think, had a lot of smoke coming from it as they came off of turn number two.
Chad McCombie in at 07.
There's Jared Fitzpatrick.
Jared Fitzpatrick.
Seven. I thought it was a 07 of Chad McCombie.
This Chad was coming off of turn number two. You see that 07 in the back?
Looks like steam, doesn't it?
It does look like steam. I don't see a whole lot of damage to the front end of that where he may have poked a hole in the radiator. But NASCAR just wanted to take a look at the racetrack and make sure there was nothing put down.
What would have caused steam? I mean, other than water being put on the headers or
something
out there, how do you?
You're not running around here at full speed, so you're not pushing the air through the radiator to cool it. So you will run warmer during the caution flag. Adam, what's going on with Johnny Benson?
You talk about split second decisions. As soon as that caution came out, the trucks were coming off of turn two. Trip Bruce, the crew chief for Johnny Benson, said, come in here and put four tires on it right now. He gives up a position in the top five. They will also make an adjustment to free him up. Four tires for Benson at lap 69, his first service of the day.
You talking about split second decision? It took them about five or six laps to make that decision. And they made it in a split second. When the caution came back out and they extended the caution, Trip Bruce said, we got it. We got to pit. We got to get all this done right now. Will he come back in and get some gas, Phil?
He might as well. Yeah, absolutely might as well. Nothing to lose because he's going to be the very last truck.
Well, it won't work. It's one to go. And you can't get all the way down this pit road and around and back on the track without losing a lap.
Yeah, now the 17 is coming down pit road. Obviously, pace truck still on the racetrack. Timothy Peters, you see him on pit road right now.
Wow, these guys, they like you said, no one knew for sure what.
Fuel only, get the fuel in it.
Are you here? Krista, what are they talking about?
Well, they were going to come in, then they made an audible and said, stay out, and then they just got on the radio, and that's what you just heard, was coming in for Timothy Peters. Fuel only is the call. You see him here on pit road. Remember, this is a bare-bones operation. Two full-time employees, Timothy Peters and crew chief Chad Hendrick.
We talked about we weren't sure what our strategy was going to be. We still don't know what people's strategy is.
Changing it as they go.
And they don't either.
Yeah,
the one truck of Johnny Benson did not come back down pit road to put fuel in. I know it's one to go, but there still should have been plenty of time to come in, put enough fuel in it, and catch it back up with the field.
It would have been tight. But now all he has to do is get gas later. When other trucks come to pit road to get their tires and fuel, Johnny just needs gas that could give him the track position they're looking for.
Green flag back in the air. Rick Crawford, Ron Hornaday, Matt Crafton, Terry Cook, and Mike Skinner are top five. Look at the move to the inside by Hornaday.
Hornaday's going to try to follow that 13 truck. Rick Crawford is strong off of turn two on the top side of the racetrack.
And he knows exactly what he needs to do, too. He's got to pound that thing down to the bottom of the track to hold off Hornaday. Great job by Rick Crawford retaining the lead.
Crawford continuing to add to his laps led at this racetrack.
You remember Krista talking about Cowboy being a little bit nervous this morning. Well, a lot of times you talk about pit strategy. Well, we're going to do whatever the leader does. Well, they're leading right now, so they're the ones that are going to dictate.
You've led all 67 laps.
Got a really strong truck, too. He's able to put some pressure on Johnny Sauter. Look at these guys battling back in the pack.
Remember, a lot of these trucks have already pitted. There's Kyle Busch right side of your screen, David Starr, Stacy Compton, Brian Scott. They've all been to pit road already.
Brett Butler up on the outside making his first truck series start for Andy Hillenburg. Trying to get a feel for these big heavy trucks. Hadn't done this a lot. Good kid.
Doing a nice job on the staying out of the way there. Ryan Scott gets by on the inside. There, Crawford trying to get to the inside of Johnny Sauter. Can't make the move.
He better make it in a hurry.
That steer is coming up there on him.
You get a little rear steer.
Longhorn Chevrolet of Ron Hornaday running second now again. Crawford looking to the inside. Johnny Sauter doesn't give him any slack.
Now
Johnny Sauter's quite a few laps down. He's being scored at
now
least
he's nine.
10.
Now yeah, he's
nine laps down. So
look at Hornaday go to the outside, Rick.
Rick Crawford stays on the back bumper of Johnny Sauter. Hornaday looks to the outside, doesn't complete the pass, but he's going to do it again in turn number three to see if it'll work there.
Johnny Sauter is slowing them down enough that Hornaday said, I'm going to try the outside. Then Rick Crawford moved to the inside.
Three wide at Martinsville doesn't work.
I bet you Rick Crawford's thinking, Johnny Sauter, you're messing up what would be a really good day for me right now.
Here comes Hornaday on the outside. Well, that's Johnny Sauter. Hornaday pushing him. Hornaday pushing Crawford now.
That's what Crawford needed. He just needed one turn where he could get the gas down, put a little gap between he and Hornaday. He's got a better truck than Ron right now, but Ron's able to lean on him and probably pass him.
He's going to get to the inside here. He's going to beat him down to turn number three.
Hornaday taking the lead away from Rick Crawford.
Wow.
Chris Devota.
Well, if we thought Cowboy Starlin was nervous, I was nervous down here watching the interaction between that 13 and 14. Obviously, they had the issue a little bit earlier in the race. The team reminded Rick, said, hey, go ahead and move that 13 out of the way. He did it to you earlier. So there was some nail biting down here, that's for sure.
You know, the thing I think that's interesting is Ron Hornaday right now is our leader. He stayed on the racetrack through every caution flag. Kevin Harvick, his teammate and truck owner, was running in the top five, so had good track position, and he decided to pit back on lap number 64.
And right now, Kevin Harvick's being scored in the 15th position.
But this is all going to change. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's going to have to take place between now and the end of this race on pit road. These guys trying to figure out how to win this race via their pit road strategy. I'd say the next time the caution flies, the leaders will be on pit road.
I think so, too.
Hornaday, Crawford, Matt Crafton, Terry Cook, Mike Skinner.
I think a lot of the crew chiefs wanted to see lap 90 to 100 before they made their first pit stop. We've completed 82 laps right now, going to get ready to complete 83. So we're getting very close to that window.
Ricky Carmichael in the number four truck moving his way up. He's in the 12th spot now, Adam.
And he one of the guys that's on a little bit of a different strategy. Billy Wilburn, his crew chief, wanted to get him out of balance with the other drivers because he started 29. So they had to do something to create track position. Ricky pitted at lap 50, got four tires. He will have to come back for fuel and an adjustment later in the race. But your first ever trip to Martinsville, 29th, the 14th, and 76 laps, including a pit stop in there. That's pretty impressive.
Great battle for fifth right now. Dennis Setzer gets to the inside of Mike Skinner to take over that fifth spot. I'm telling you, we were talking earlier, Dennis Setzer could drive a pace car around here and have a shot to win.
He is so smooth.
I love watching that man operate. He's racing for the fourth spot. Look at that. Just like you said, smooth but fast. He's able to get to the gas in a hurry and drives right around Terry Cook.
Adam Alexander.
This has gone from 17th to 5th, which is very, very good for him and not surprising. And what perhaps would be scary for the competition, the fact that his crew chief Randy Dean told me this morning, we ran out of practice time. We had three more things we wanted to try that would make us better, but I think it's pretty good, and I think Dennis is proving him right on track.
I talked to Dennis on Saturday before the original planned start of the race, and he felt like that he wasn't exactly where he wanted to be, but Randy and Dennis probably got their heads together, maybe made some changes this morning. What little changes NASCAR would allow you to make, and it looks like he's got a pretty good truck.
Going to third spot.
Solid race truck as he takes third away from Matt Crafton. Everyone chasing that 33 of Hornaday. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Toyota. Moving forward. One guy not moving forward as quickly as he would want it is the four of Ricky Carmichael. He brings out our fifth caution of the day. Let's take a look.
Got a good battle with Jarrett Fitzpatrick. They get together coming off four. They make some more contact. Now Ricky's going to get down into turn number one on the inside, and he's going to bounce off
that
curb.
At those back tires. He got into a wheel hop situation. The back tires got to jump, and he had to let off the brake to keep it from spinning out. But when he let off the brake, he ran into the side of the seven.
Ricky was not able to get back going without losing a lap, but we have leaders on pit road.
Adam Alexander.
And Matt Crafton has been solid. After starting eighth, he has stayed in the top five all day long. No talk of changes on the radio. They will get their four tires here, and I would anticipate they come back down for fuel. Krista?
Rick Crawford's truck has been very good in one and two. The plan for him, just to pit for four tires. No chassis adjustments for the 14. They'll come back in for fuel. Meanwhile, up front with the 33, pit strategy call, fuel only, pack and full, no tires for Ron Hornaday.
Contact there for Crawford, though. Coming out of his pit stall, Chris Fontaine in the 84 looks like he got into the right front. There's Rick Wren on top of the pit box for Ron Hornaday.
Now, Hornaday didn't take tires there.
Watch Crawford coming out of his pit stall. The 84 is going to come up right there.
The 84 says, I need to be making a left. Excuse me. Now, this is interesting. We saw Hornaday just get some gas.
Is that going to cause a tire issue here as we take a look at the right front of Rick Crawford?
Well, he's coming back to get his fuel so they can pull on that left right front if they choose to. Probably send somebody around. Yeah, guys coming around to the front corner to pull on it while they gas it up.
Again, five crew members can go over the wall. This is why we are under our fifth caution of the day, riding along with Ricky Carmichael. Jason White, thegunbrokers.com, 0 or 23 up front now, the 07 on the inside. Chad McCombie, a lap down truck.
This is Jay White's wheelhouse. He grew up on tracks like this. He has a good truck today too, Phil. Not only is he leading the race through his strategy, but that truck's been fast since the get-go.
He's going to have to be fast. He's got Kyle Busch all over his back bumper, and now Shane Sieg in that 07 doesn't want to give him any slack.
Yeah, that wasn't, he went down the corner, the thing wouldn't stick. Chad McCombie, that 07, gets by him. Now we look at Kyle Busch there in the 10 of James Buescher, making a little contact.
Kyle says, I'm going to need to come over, James. I hope you'll work with me on this.
Remember, Kyle's already been to pit road, put fuel and tires on, back on lap 64 and 65.
It looked like Jason White just didn't quite have his tires cleaned up, Bill. He went down into turn one. He did a great restart, but when he got to turn one, the truck just wouldn't turn, and they went on the inside of him. Now that he's up to speed, he's hanging right with him.
Battle for the lead. Kyle Busch nosing in front of that 23.
James Buescher going to try to take over the second spot. Kyle Busch gets that lead. James, first time here.
I'm impressed with James Buescher. He looked like a champ down in Daytona.
Just turned 19 Thursday.
Yep. James Buescher to the inside of Jason White. That's for second. Trying to take second away from Jason White.
And
Kyle
does.
Busch out in front.
Comes Stacy Compton and Ron Hornaday. They're in a side-by-side battle right there for the fourth spot. Hornaday gets it.
Wow. Got to spin down in turn three and four. The seven of J.R. Fitzpatrick goes around.
Gets it right. No caution.
No caution flag has come out.
Well, that left front tire is flat, isn't it?
Yep.
Calm down, man. Just calm down. Take your time here.
Butch Hilton, team manager, crew chief on that seven truck.
What do you mean take my time? I can't be taking my time. I got a flat tire.
Take another look at this.
He's on the very inside of a three wide situation. Bounces off the curb, makes contact with TJ Bell in the 11 truck.
You know, he would have been fine if he had to run into that curb, but that just jumped him sideways. And now he's got a flat tire up high off turn two.
Kyle Busch continues to lead. James Buescher now running second. Ron Hornaday has taken over the third spot from Jason White. Jason's fourth.
Chad McCombie in the 07. That's a lap down truck. Pinched in between now. Kyle Busch and James Buescher.
Hornaday tries to look up on the outside of Buescher. I like the way Ron races. He races like his hair's on fire. Never laugh. It's, you know what you got. A guy that's going to give you everything he has.
And I think that's what you have to have in this truck series. These races are shorter. This race is half the length of the Sprint Cup race yesterday.
He didn't get down to turn one and say, well, I just have to follow this guy through here. He got down to turn one. He was a little bit slower. He said, wonder what's out there. I'll go up high and try to get around Buescher. Didn't work.
But he tried it.
But he tried.
It might have worked.
It might have worked, and he didn't lose a darn thing.
Kyle Busch right in the middle of two lap down trucks. Johnny Sauter in front of him. Chad McCombie behind him.
You know, it's pretty odd for us to see Kyle Busch leading in one of these Truck Series races.
The successes that Kyle Busch has already felt in the 2009 season.
One way to do it, I guess.
Hasn't he won every weekend?
He's won something every weekend. I was just going to say.
Since Daytona. But he has to win today or his streak's messed up.
Absolutely. This is his last opportunity. Our seldom used Monday race.
Yeah, he's usually won by now.
Here comes Kevin Harvick looking to the inside of Brian Scott.
The Whelen Toyota of Todd Bodine right in front of him. That's our Whelen onboard.
You see how you have to race here, Phil? I mean, he barely ran into Brian Scott. But we're talking trucks running 100 miles an hour, barely running into each other, and that's okay. I love that.
Stacy Compton, the 60 truck, Weiler.com on the inside of J.R. Fitzpatrick. Remember, J.R. had to make an unscheduled pit stop for that left rear tire flat.
You wonder what that does to you? Three laps.
Stacy didn't quite have him cleared there. He lacked about 3 feet, but made it work.
The caution didn't come out when J.R. got turned around, and so he's still trying to stay up with this group.
But this pit road is extremely long, Rick. So when he had the problem with a flat tire, just coming down pit road and changing two tires cost him three laps.
Johnny Benson able to get by the 7 of Jared Fitzpatrick before he got to the lap truck of the 89.
It's a good battle there, four trucks. Stacy Compton leads that group.
Problems in turn number two. The 85 gets turned around one more time. That's Brent Raymer. And this time the caution will come out again. Brent Raymer brought our fourth caution of the day out. Now this is the sixth time that we have been slowed.
Just a little bit of damage to that left rear corner. Very incidental.
I believe Ricky Carmichael might get our Aaron's lucky dog.
Ricky Carmichael does get the free pass.
Looks like Brent might have got a little bit of help from Johnny Sauter in that 13 truck.
He's had trouble getting off turn two this year, hasn't he?
Johnny might not be one of the more popular drivers at the end of this race.
He had a lot of trouble at Daytona getting off turn two.
That was ugly.
So our sixth caution of the afternoon has come out, and surprise, Kyle Busch is in front. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Verizon Wireless. Get the inside track from Penske Racing, race analysis from our drivers, plus highlights and more on VCast. Again, six caution flags have flown today. Want to take a look at our Toyota top performers of the race. Kyle Busch out in front. Stacy Compton running fourth. Todd Bodine in the fifth spot. So three Toyotas in the top five.
Great run for Stacy Compton, that 60 truck. He was very fast in practice. Didn't get the qualifying run in that he wanted, but looks like he has a pretty good truck here.
We'd almost expect that from a Virginia native.
He's always been good at this place.
It's Todd Bodine in that Whelen number 30.
I think he came here in 96 for the first time with Jim Harris's cup car, qualified in the top 10.
Yeah, qualified ninth. I remember that day well, Phil, because very seldom did someone you never really heard of show up in a car you didn't know and do anything much. And he qualified in the top 10, and this place was a buzz about Stacy Compton and Jim Harris's car.
Another guy who's had a lot of success at this racetrack, Mike Skinner. Found victory lane a few times at this track. Tonight, tune into This Week in NASCAR with Steve Burns, Greg Biffle, and our own Michael Waltrip. The panel will recap Martinsville plus preview Texas, which includes profiling some unusual happenings that have taken place in the Lone Star State. Don't miss This Week in NASCAR tonight, 8 p.m. Eastern, only on Speed. Now, don't speed getting back to the studios, Michael.
I'm all set. My GPS tells me I'll be there in an hour and 55 minutes.
Very good. Ricky Carmichael back on the track.
He just got the lucky dog, so he's back in shape after losing a lap because of that spin. So
See how far he can fight back up through there.
Kyle Busch leading the field back to the green flag. James Buescher right behind him. 23-year-old Kyle Busch, 19-year-old James Buescher in front of this field.
I know Kyle Busch is 23, and we talk about it all the time, but it's hard to imagine that he's done what he's done at 23 years old. He has 46 wins among the three divisions, as we see David Starr having some problems up against the wall in that Zachary Toyota.
I think he's got a flat right front. The thing just went straight up into the fence. I don't know if he made some contact on that restart, but couldn't turn his truck when he got to turn two.
As we talked about, it's just going to kill him, too. This green flag pit stop.
See if we can see some contact that maybe cut his tire.
Into the wall there, right at the start-finish line.
That's actually, he was the truck behind that. That was the 29 of Mikey Kyle.
Looked like he might have cut that tire when he hit Mikey Kyle, you think?
Yeah, well, Terry Cook did a nice job and his teammate of avoiding David Starr.
Again, coming to the start-finish line.
Right there.
Yeah, there was
contact.
The contact.
It was Mikey Kyle into the wall right by our camera.
But David Starr is just going to really pay the penalty now, and more than likely will be three laps down when this all shakes out. He gets back off of pit road.
Adam Alexander, what's Kevin Harvick thinking about the strategy of this race?
So far, Rick, what they have done is pit at lap 64 for tires, top off the fuel tank at lap 94. That is very similar to the strategy they had mapped out for the race here on Saturday. I talked to Ernie Cope, but he said, barring a real long green flag run, we do not plan to pit again. And as of lap 118, they needed 31 more laps of caution to be able to go the distance on fuel.
There's a good chance they're going to get 31.
Yeah, because we've already had some of those anyway. Yeah. So right now, Kyle Busch has opened up over a 1 second lead over James Buescher.
And James, you can see there, has got some traffic behind him. Sauter right on his bumper, and then Hornaday. So he's holding that group up, Bill. He's got to be careful. Somebody will get in the back of him.
Kyle Busch is checking out on the field right now, Krista.
Yeah, and they are also playing the fuel strategy game. They need a few more laps of caution also. Kyle getting on the radio and asking crew chief Doug George what the magic number is. Doug George said 60, 6-0. That's what they need. By the way, way back, lap 64, Kyle had said the track is not working. It's gone crazy. He's the one going crazy out on the track right now.
Here in caution coming out for debris in turn two. Again, that's where David Starr had ended up when he got into the wall with his right front tire being cut down.
Well, that's going to give Kyle Busch more caution laps, as well as Kevin Harvick. And remember now, Kevin Harvick talking about needing some more caution laps. He pitted almost 30 laps after Kyle Busch did.
There's that debris we were talking about. Safety crews will get out there and clean the track back off, and we'll go back to green flag racing. Again, you're watching the Camping World Truck Series on Speed. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by New Shell Nitrogen Enriched Gasolines. By State Farm, where great coverage meets great rates. By the all-new 09 F-150. It's not just a new truck, it's a new F-150. And by Lowe's, for all your home improvement needs, Lowe's. Let's build something together.
You know, the strategies are being affected quite a lot by all the trucks that are on the lead lap, Phil. That's Norm Benning getting his free pass right now. And that makes 26 trucks on the lead lap.
Since we instituted the lucky dog, there's been an average of 23 trucks finish on the lead lap in this 250-lap race.
Green flag popped back out, and that enables Kyle Busch to jump back up to the front. In front of Johnny Sauter. Johnny Sauter still a few laps down, 10. Nine, actually, to be exact now.
Well, Kyle enjoys that 13 of Johnny Sauter, run a little interference for him, but it doesn't look like James Buescher in the 10 is able to maintain the pace. He wasn't able to maintain the pace before the caution came out that Kyle Busch can.
A year ago, that 33 of Ron Hornaday ran out of gas right at the end of the race. Well, they wanted to make sure that they weren't going to have that happen again. They came down pit road on this most recent caution.
Martinsville was the most interesting race for our championship battle last year. Running second with just on the last lap, Johnny Benson gets spun out, loses 100 points. Hornaday runs out of gas in the fall, loses about that many points. And what they do, it was one position difference down at Homestead when the season ended. But here played the biggest role of any track in the whole year.
Definitely did. Let's find out a little bit more, Krista.
There was a lot of dissension down here in the 33 pit. They had planned to stay out on that caution. Rick Wren wanted to come in about lap 140 to 150. Ravon Hornaday, the driver, said, no, I am falling back. Kyle Busch is driving away. What are we going to do? Then the commitment was not made soon enough. Ron coming on the radio and saying, Rick, I've got to know sooner what you want me to do. So they did come in for those four tires, but there was a lot of arguing going on the 33 radio.
There's a lot of arguing going on the racetrack.
As he's moving up, we had some positions fought for, and that 60 got moved out of the way. Stacy Compton got pushed completely out of the way. Look at him bump and bang right now.
Three wide. Tab O'Dine drives to the inside to make it three wide. He's going to make contact with Stacy getting in the corner. Stacy does a terrific job saving that truck, but meanwhile loses about three positions in the process. Here's another view right of your screen.
Watch Tab O'Dine. He gets down to the inside of Stacy and he says, don't come over, don't come over. Okay, if you do, I'm going to hit you. And that's exactly the way it worked out. Todd was in a perfect position. He had his truck under control. He was down low on the brakes. He knew that if Stacy Compton came over, it wasn't going to hurt him any.
And if he tried to avoid Stacy, he's going to hit the curb and then hit Stacy harder and would have spun Stacy out.
James Buescher still trying to find a way to get back under the inside line. Timothy Peters now just inside of him.
You know, we talked about Timothy Peters and this being having a makeshift pit crew and what a great job he's doing. This is not a bad place not to have the greatest pit crew because of the strategy you can play. You might pit when you're the only truck on pit road to get your tires, and then you just might get gas when there's only a couple others. You mix it up considering what kind of pit crew you do have and to ensure that you don't lose any more positions than necessary.
There's our pole sitter and early leader, Rick Crawford, trying to make his way back up towards the front. He got by his teammate, James Buescher. Now Mike Skinner, the 5 truck's going to try to get to the inside of James Buescher.
That Timothy Peters truck is running in the 6th spot, but darn, he's been smoking for the last 100 laps.
There's Hornaday again, working his way back up toward the front. Now he sets his sights on TJ Bell in the 11.
Ron's going to get to the inside, has position, is going to be able to get that truck turned in the center, get underneath TJ and beat him down to the other end of the racetrack, turn 3.
Ron's restarted 25th or so. He's up into the top 20, running 19th, going around TJ Bell. He's up to the 18th spot.
Johnny Benson right on the back bumper of the 60 of Stacy Compton. Our State Farm biggest movers has to go to Stacy Compton, and that's just not the move that he made to the outside line earlier. That's actually track position, gaining 17 spots as Stacy Compton.
Right now he's losing a little bit of touch with Kevin Harvick, who runs in the 3rd position. So that's why Johnny Benson now feels a bit of sense of urgency because he sees that gap widening in front of Stacy Compton.
There he goes. He's got to run to the inside of Stacy. Stacy spun his tires a little bit off that turn. Johnny opened the door for Timothy Peters. Can Timothy Peters run into the top 5 with that 17 truck?
Smoking the whole time?
He's going to try. A couple Virginia kids running side by side. Well, I say kids. Stacy Compton probably doesn't fall into that category a lot, but. And a little bumping and banging still. Here comes Crawford to the inside of Stacy Compton.
Boy, somebody opens that door, and it seemed like the whole world wants to walk through it, huh?
Yeah, Stacy's doing his best to try to get back in the middle of something. Now he's going to try to beat Skinner down to the corner. Not able to do it.
He was trying to close the door and he couldn't get it done.
He's got him a gap now. Falls in behind Skinner. James Buescher's not quite up to those trucks, so he's able to get back on the bottom of the racetrack.
Shook out in the 8th spot. James Buescher right now runs 9th. Brian Scott, the 16 truck, is in the 10th position.
Just over 100 laps remaining. Again, 250 scheduled for this one. Just over 131 miles.
Check out these the 2nd and 3rd place trucks of Bodine and Harvick are closing in on our leader, Kyle Busch. Kyle had squirted away from these guys quite a lot, and Harvick's been faster than Bodine. He's been all over the back of Todd. He can't make a move, but now Todd and Kevin both are starting to run down our leader, Kyle Busch.
Todd told me, he said, I know I didn't have a good qualifying effort, but he said, keep an eye on me. I think I have a great race truck. And here he is right now running 2nd.
Well, and you know, they used that poor qualifying effort to mix up their strategy a little bit. Came to pit road early, got their service done, and now he finds himself in the second spot.
He came down pit road for the first time on lap number 50, came back in on lap number 94.
Remember, the fuel mileage concern came up about conserving fuel when you can. We've had a pretty sizable green flag run here where Kyle Busch was able to get out front, put some distance between himself and second, and now we're seeing Todd Bodine and Kevin Harvick reel him back in.
I'm like you, Michael. I think Kevin has a better truck right now than Todd, but he knows he has 100 laps to go here. There's no sense beating that front end off it. He's already got some damage from early on when he was trying to get by Shane Sieg.
But I just love the way Kevin Harvick races. He just uses his brain. There's no sense in pushing it right now. You're right. They're both keeping pace or even gaining on the leader. We'll play it cool here, take care of our stuff. You know, we need to make sure we have plenty of gas and plenty of tires for the end of this thing. So why hurry? Obviously, he's got a fast truck.
Talk about tires. Adam Alexander, what's going on with Benson?
He just came on the radio, Rick, and said he can feel his tires going away. Now, the unfortunate thing for him, with the number of trucks on the lead lap that there are, it would be challenged to get back to pit road. I think that was more feedback for future reference. They're not talking about pitting, but certainly he is losing some grip as the run continues.
Well, then he's got a chance right here to take care of that.
Norm Benning gets turned around in the 57 right at the start-finish line, bringing out our eighth caution of the day.
Norm's got a couple of free passes today, but I don't think it's going to do him any good. Looks like he got in the outside wall a little bit.
I'm keeping my eye on the Hornaday. He's moved up to the 13th position now. Just take a look at the replay. What happened to Norm? There he is coming off turn number four sideways. Makes contact with the inside wall. Ron Hornaday has made his way up to the 13th spot. Remember, he was among the last group of trucks to pit on lap number 129.
He's just hoping some of those guys up ahead of him might come to pit road and get a couple free spots right here. It looks like Stacy Compton in front of him is coming to pit road, but that's the extent of it. So he'll move up to 12th. He's got the best tires on the track. And about 100 laps to get to the front. Can he do it, Phil?
I don't think so.
Competition is too stiff when you start trying to pass into the 10th, 8th, up towards the top
five. They just get harder as you go.
And again, this caution helping out those that were thinking they were going to be close on fuel. So a few more caution laps here, helping out guys like Kyle Busch out in front of this field as they go to work on Stacy Compton's number 60.
I think Stacy had fallen to the out, you know, just to down into the bottom of the top 10, and he felt like that he wasn't going to be able to beat anybody in front of him. So he really felt like he had nothing to lose. Otherwise, he's going to finish maybe 9th or 10th.
Kyle Busch in front. Can he make it 3 wins in a row in 2009 in the Camping World Truck Series? Welcome back to the Kroger 250. It's Kyle Busch in front of Todd Bodine and Kevin Harvick. They're your top three. Green flag back in the air.
It looked like the 30 of Todd Bodine, the 2 of Kevin Harvick, may have had a little better truck before the caution came out than Kyle Busch. We'll see what happens now. Johnny Sauter on the inside trying to get another lap back, racing Kyle Busch.
Boy, Kyle Busch is so good on these restarts. Not only when he goes through the gears, but just making a couple of corners, getting himself a gap. That's where his gap came from on the last restart, and they never could catch it back. Now he's put himself in front of the 13 truck, got a pick between he and the second place truck.
He drove in 3 on that restart hard,
and he made
the
it
thing
work.
Stuck.
He made it work.
Take a look at this, a good battle for 5th. Timothy Peters and Mike Skinner. Skinner with the preferred line on the bottom of the racetrack. Peters a little bit aggressive coming out of the turn. Oh, some more bumping and banging.
Skinner said, that 7 truck's in front of me. I need to move to the outside, and he did, and Timothy Peters was there. Fortunately, backed off and got on the brakes and kept from having very significant contact with the outside wall.
That's hurt Timothy Peters, though. He's got James Buescher on the inside of him. Makes a good corner there to try to get ahead of Buescher, but can he do it?
Can't come down on the racetrack. Buescher into the back of the 17, and caution comes out once again.
Sometimes you get saved by the caution. Peters was just ahead of Buescher, and then the caution falls. Now he can get back in line and try to regroup. Skinner got on the inside of him. They bounced around a little bit, and he lost 2 or 3 spots, had a top 5 run going.
Debris once again bringing out this, the 9th caution of the day.
I think maybe Timothy went up there and told Mike he didn't like the way that went down.
I think probably so. Remember now, this is when they came off turn number four. Timothy got a little bit sideways, and then Mike said, hey, I got to get to the outside.
Look at, he got into the wall there,
yeah, look
too.
At the rear bumper of the 5 truck. That's probably what brought off this caution flag, part of that tailgate there.
Flapping in the wind for Mike Skinner.
These caution laps are playing into Kevin Harvick's hand. We knew he needed some more caution laps. He's getting them.
Kyle Busch both looking for fuel mileage to help out their fuel mileage.
87 laps to go when they get to the line this time.
Should be a pretty quick caution here.
Probably a good chance we'll have some more caution laps, I would think.
There's a good chance. We're on our ninth caution.
Seems to be a theme.
Well, I think when we come to short tracks, we sometimes expect that they're going to bump and bang, and every now and then somebody gets turned around, some debris gets left on the racetrack. But the best place to be, obviously, is in front, and you've got Kyle Busch out there now. He hasn't had to deal as much with Johnny Sauter as, for example, Rick Crawford did at the beginning of this race when it was really a headache for Crawford.
Johnny Sauter made Rick Crawford's life a miserable up at the front. He couldn't get rid of him, couldn't do away with him, and finally wound up losing the lead to Ron Hornaday because of Johnny Sauter.
So the field lines back up again as we're getting ready for the restart. And I think now that we've seen, obviously, 150-plus laps as we're down to the final 100, we've seen a couple different strategies start to play out. And right now, this fuel mileage play for Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch is looking pretty good.
I think the most interesting strategy right now is what Ron Hornaday is doing. He's back in the 12th spot, and he's got the freshest tires on the racetrack. We think, or me and Todd do, we believe that he can go up and win the race.
Right.
Phil's not so sure.
I don't think he can get back to the top five now, but Kyle Busch pitted a number of laps before Kevin Harvick. They're not talking about needing the caution laps quite as much, but I think Kevin Harvick should be within his window right now of getting to the end of this race without having to stop again.
And you know why Kevin's so nervous? He ran out last year.
Exactly.
So you want to have a little extra just in case, especially when you have that history.
A little bit more on that. Let's go to Adam Alexander.
And actually, under this caution, they're not even talking about fuel conservation. They're talking about the chassis. Ernie Cope, the crew chief, just asked Kevin about the sunshine coming out and if that had helped his truck. Kevin said, nope, I'm just too tight. And in regard to that skirmish we saw on the racetrack a moment ago between Mike Skinner and the 17 of Timothy Peters, Skinner just came on the radio and said, tell the 17 I was just trying to get around the 7. I wasn't trying to put him in the wall. It's way too early for that.
They've been trying to put people in the wall since they threw the green.
Yeah, there's 85 laps to go. Way too early.
And Timothy Peters didn't care why Mike Skinner ran him into the wall. He just knew that he did.
He did. Ran him into the wall. So we're seeing a little bit more sheet metal damage on these trucks as we wind down. 85 laps to go. Kyle Busch takes the green. We're back underway.
Kyle Busch trying to do a little stutter step there to try to beat that 13 truck. He's got a half a truck link on him. He'll see if he can beat him off turn number four, or turn number two.
He does. Will he dive down in front of him? Yes.
So Johnny Sauter again scored eight laps down to the field.
He's gotten three of them back. So you got to like the way Johnny Sauter's thinking. He's thinking he needs to get all of them back, and he's had a chance to do so. He's been right there.
We like what he's doing, but probably nobody on the racetrack that he's that he's racing around like Kyle Busch and Todd Bodine, Rick Crawford earlier.
I think right now Kyle Busch likes what he's doing because he's right between he and the second place truck.
Chris DeVoto.
Well, it's all about the numbers game. We may be back under green, but our two leaders, the 51 and the 30, they are looking for some more yellow flags. They are going to be just a little bit short if we don't have any more. Right now, they're asking for the number. How many more caution laps do we need? Todd Bodine needed 20 more before that caution. Kyle Busch said he now needs 17.
17 caution laps in our final 81. I don't know. It's going to be close. We're going to see, I think, a really close end to this race as far as people trying to conserve fuel.
Great battle for fifth right now. Rick Crawford, the 14 trucker, pole sitter on the inside, trying to get by Johnny Benson.
Guess who's joined this battle for fifth, Phil? He's got a steer on his hood.
Yeah, at 33. Ron Hornaday back there.
He pitted, dropped all the way outside the top 20, and has raced up to the top 10 and has is in the pack where fifth place is.
Just got by Matt Crafton.
Took that spot away from Matt Crafton.
Remember, I was talking to Rick Wren this morning. He said, remember, we got beat by tires last year. We don't want to be in that situation again. Look at Rick Wren. Three wide.
And Hornaday will go in there.
Three, and Ron Hornaday stays on the gas long enough to take the position away. There's a battle for second. Kevin Harvick puts the nose.
There's going to be contact right there.
Look who's joined this battle for second.
A little bumping and banging right there between Todd Bodine and Kevin Harvick. Harvick on the inside, Bodine on the outside. Here comes the five of Mike Skinner.
Is he going to make it three wide?
He is as they go down the front stretch. It is Mike Skinner on the inside. Mike gives up a little position and allows Kevin Harvick to take the curb spot.
We heard Mike Skinner talking all day Friday about how confident he was in that truck, and now here we are inside 75 laps to go, and he's trying to get the second spot.
Oh, look at Todd sideways. Getting sideways.
Todd Bodine, he tries to keep it out of the wall, bounces off the wall as he comes out of turn
coming
number four.
Here. Come on, come on. No caution, come on.
Damage to the right front of that truck now. It's rubbing on the right front tire.
The good thing
right
about
front bottom of the splitter, Mike. Right front bottom of the splitter.
That's got, he's got a pit. That splitter's all back into the tire, and the splitter is made out of Kevlar. It'll rip through a tire in 2 seconds.
Todd Bodine running second. He was battling with Kevin Harvick. Harvick takes a position away. Bodine into the wall. Take a look.
He's on the outside. This is going down in turn number three. Todd gets in the throttle, gets a little bit sideways, does a great job saving it, but he just gets behind on the steering, makes a little bit of contact. Right now,
the debris.
Right now, he's hoping that piece of splitter falls off, but not into the right front tire.
It won't run long like that, Phil. Look at that.
You heard him driving the whole time, though, on the throttle, off the throttle, trying to get that truck straight. There's Ron Hornaday trying to take over the fifth position.
Up into the top five is Hornaday is going to use the old chrome horn.
There goes a tire. I guarantee you that thing's going flat.
So Ron Hornaday taking the spot away from Todd Bodine. Hornaday up into the top five. Bodine moves up the racetrack. Bodine needs a caution now. Timothy Peters goes by.
Thank you, Phil.
For agreeing with you, I'm sure.
Yeah, we had a little bit of a disagreement about where that truck would wind up when this race was over. He thought outside the top 10. Man, I can't believe that tire hadn't blown out already.
Yeah, me either. Todd's continuing to fight, just desperately trying to catch a caution flag here to get to pit road. But meanwhile, losing many, many positions. Remember now, he came in this race second in points to Kyle Busch. We know Kyle Busch is not going to run all the races, so theoretically, Todd would be considered our leader, but now he's losing positions with every lap.
Todd Bodine was 25 points behind Kyle Busch coming into this race.
Look right there behind the 88, Jason White. He's been battling up toward the front all day long, trying to get inside the top 10. What a great run for Jason.
Jason right behind that 30 of Todd Bodine. Krista, what are they talking about?
Well, the crew is up on the wall ready just in case. They're worried that they've got that tire rub, the right front. He did get on the radio and said, thinks it's going flat. They are not in panic mode yet. The crew is ready if and when that tire goes down.
He knows right now that if he comes to pit road, he will lose probably three laps. Ron Hornaday is going to drive by Johnny Benson. That's the fourth spot right there.
And remember, he's about a quarter of a lap behind our leader, but his tires are newer. So in the next caution flies, there's
Jason
the caution.
White goes around.
No caution,
no
yet.
Caution.
It doesn't fly. Todd Bodine says, darn it.
Said no caution, keep digging.
Remember the last time we were at one of these truck races, the battle between the 2 and the 51 at Atlanta? Shaping up to be a replay of that.
Well, I tell you what, both of them have to be a little bit nervous about this long green flag run. They're both looking for fuel mileage. And they've talked about teams as far as laps that they need.
See, Jason White gets in the back of Matt Crafton. I would have think that was probably the precursor to what happened to Jason here.
Yeah, and you generally better make sure if you hit somebody, you can get away from them until they calm down.
Kind of like Jimmy did yesterday, Jimmy Johnson, when he took the lead from Denny Hamlin.
He bought himself two or three laps, and by that time, Denny had gotten his emotions in check. What a great job by those two yesterday. I loved watching the highlights and the replays of that battle late in the race. And then hearing Denny Hamlin say, I love racing with these guys. They're the best in the world. Sometimes you just get outrun, and I think in that occasion, Jimmy Johnson drove a perfect race and got the victory.
Right now, Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick are battling it up front. Adam, what are they saying about that two and fuel mileage?
They feel very good about it. I just went over and talked to crew chief Ernie Cope, said, are you good to go the distance? Have you got enough caution flags? And as we talk about Harvick, we have a spin with one of his young drivers on track.
Ricky Carmichael, there's also another truck involved in this. There was two trucks spinning along the backstretch when they came out of turn number two. Let's take another look.
There's the 84 of Chris Fontaine on the outside. Ricky comes off turn two. They make a little bit of contact, and then they get hung together. And Chris goes around, then Ricky goes around and gets into the outside wall.
Looked like Ricky had the same thing that sort of happened at Todd Bodine. He couldn't get his steering caught up. He got into the side of the 84 by certainly not wasn't intended, but the truck just got to swarping back and forth, and he couldn't quite catch up with it.
Swarping?
Harry Gant.
Yep. That's what I thought.
I thought you were going to science it out for us once again.
See, Hermie Sadler right there does a nice job avoiding the four. They made a little bit of contact. TNT on board Hermie's truck.
I don't care how much short track racing you've done to warm up for this place. You can't simulate Martinsville. There's no place like it on the circuit, and Ricky's had a tough day.
This is the ride that Ricky Carmichael just went on to bring out our 10th caution of the day. Green flag back in the air for the Camping World Truck Series. Kroger 250 from Martinsville Speedway. Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick, 1 and 2 as they enter turn 1 and 2.
But watch that 33 truck running fourth right now. Remember, he has the freshest tires of anybody in this group. There's a little bit of a question whether the 51 and the 2 will have enough fuel to get to the end. I think Kevin Harvick and the 2 definitely will. He pitted back on lap number 94, but Kyle Busch pitted way back on lap number 65.
Boy, Ron Hornaday feels good right now. He drives the outside of Skinner's, got those fresher tires, and he is making it work.
Hornaday taking third away from Mike Skinner.
Guess who's next on the hit parade?
Yeah, his boss. Ron Hornaday right on the back bumper of the number 2 of Kevin Harvick. The fresher tires again for Ron Hornaday. Trying to make the move up through the field and get back to the front. Adam Alexander.
Ah, Rick, it's always nice when the boss pays you a compliment. Under that last caution, Harvick, who's running second, said, what about that 33 running back through the field? Hornaday in the top five, and Harvick better not pay him off too much because it won't be long before Ron's trying to steal a spot from him.
Looks like Ron's run up against some competition he's not ready to deal with yet. Harvick, he was right on his bumper a lap or so ago, and Harvick's driven away from that 33 truck.
Yeah, Kevin actually got by the 13 of Johnny Sauter, the truck that's so many laps down.
Speaking of laps down, the 30 of Todd Bodine again with some issues to the right front. Krista, have they got that all fixed?
Well, they hope so, Rick. They came in, they had to take just right side tires because they had to spend the time working to get the splitter out from underneath the right front tire. Well, they planned on coming back in for lefts, but they did not want to miss the restart, so it was just right side tires and some splitter damage for the 30.
I tell you, that tells you how tough these Goodyear tires are. I can't believe that tire didn't cut as hard as it was rubbing on that splitter, but it didn't.
And again, Todd Bodine stayed on the racetrack long enough for the caution to come out that wasn't caused by him, so he has not lost any laps. He's still on the lead lap, running in the 19th spot. Here's a battle for ninth, door to door. Dennis Setzer in the 8, Matt Crafton in the 88.
As we talk about these tires, the new right side tires that Goodyear has here. Well, Kevin Harvick just ran his fastest lap of the race just one lap ago, and remember, he put tires on back on lap number 64.
So over 130 some laps on his tires, and he just ran his fastest lap of the race, and it was the fastest lap on the track that lap. He's catching Kyle Busch.
Stacy Compton in the 60 on the inside, Matt Crafton in that 88 on the outside. Right behind them, Ken Schrader in the 52.
Schrader's done a good job. Kept that truck out of trouble, although it's all wrinkled up. Kept it heading in the right direction, we should say.
That's pretty normal though here at Martinsville. I mean, that's the type of damage you have on an uneventful day here at Martinsville.
Well, it's going to be eventful. We've got Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick pulling away from the field. They run 1 and 2. It's going to be settled here shortly at Martinsville Speedway. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Sprint. NASCAR Sprint Cup Mobile. It'll change the way you experience the race. 11th caution of the day has come out. You see the damage to the 23. It wasn't only Jason White involved in this one. Let's take a look.
Todd Bodine gets on the inside of Max Pappas, and Max is okay with that. But his spotter must have said, clear behind Todd. And Jason said, no, it's not.
And it might have been for a split second, but that's how quickly things happen here at Martinsville. Jason came along to try to take that spot, use that hole that Todd opened up, and unfortunately, Max had already come back down to the bottom of the racetrack, and there's the contact, and James Buescher right behind Jason White, absolutely nowhere to go, gets in the back of Jason. Worked out okay for Max.
Max is still going. Jason's got some severe damage to that truck of his, the gunbroker.com Dodge. See, leaving the pit road there. Look at that truck.
They pushed the hood back down. It looks like short track
racing.
I think
Jason's got a good truck here, too.
Oh, he's got a great truck. He's been very competitive. But made a bit of a mistake, roughed a guy up and couldn't get away from him. That guy spun him out.
Saw Matt Crafton on pit road. Take a look at our Cheez-It race summary. It's Kyle Busch out front. There are 21 trucks still on the lead lap. We've had 3 lead changes. 11 cautions for 64 laps. That continues to go up, and that's actually good news for Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick. They thought they were going to be close. I think with this caution, they should be able to make it the remainder of the
night. I think so. I think definitely Kevin Harvick is definitely in his window. Again, Kyle Busch pitted before Kevin Harvick.
The two trucks behind Kyle Busch, Harvick and his teammate Ron Hornaday, were both faster than Kyle Busch as this race was unfolding there before the caution flew. They were significantly faster, a couple of tenths on a lap or two there, Phil. And you know how much a couple of tenths is here at Martinsville. Yeah,
that's about the separation of an entire field for a Sprint Cup race. Had we gotten qualifying in on Friday, probably no more than about 3/10 of a second would have separated the entire field.
Chris DeBoda, what are they talking about with Kyle Busch?
Well, I think they're going to be okay, like you said, but how important is this fuel strategy game? Well, Doug George, the crew chief for this truck, how did he spend his Sunday from 8:30 a.m. all the way till noon? He ran the numbers and then re-ran them and then re-ran them again. 3.5 hours of homework. Right now, Kyle's saying his truck is just getting a little bit tight in the center.
We need to buy him a calculator.
I think that was longhand or maybe used a slide rule or something. That's a lot of time to spend on those numbers.
Yeah. But I guess if you want to use, you got to run all the scenarios.
Sometimes you run your numbers and you look at them and you just think, that can't be right.
And you do it again.
Do it again.
I don't have to run those again.
I know one thing that he was looking at is the fact that we have averaged over 80 laps of caution for this race, the 250-lap race, over the last 5 years. So I'm sure that's one of the numbers that he inputted. We also have averaged 23 trucks on the lead lap since the Lucky Dog was instituted. So that's another thing that he's another number that he's instituting into his formula.
Coming up this weekend, NASCAR moves to Texas. Our coverage begins on Friday with Sprint Cup Series practice on Speed and then Sprint Cup Series qualifying. Then on Saturday, it's 2 sessions of Sprint Cup Series practice on Speed. And on Sunday, it begins with NASCAR Race Day on Speed. And then it's Sprint Cup Series racing on Fox, followed by NASCAR Victory Lane on Speed. Our coverage of NASCAR continues next weekend across the Fox networks. Green flag about to come back out. It is Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick, 1 and 2. Ron Hornaday, fresher tires back there in third. The battle has begun. Harvick looks to the inside early. Kyle Busch holding him off through 1 and 2.
Crash into one. Big crash for TJ Bell.
Problems for the 11. Look at the damage to the back and front of that truck.
Todd Bodine got down on the inside of TJ, and TJ just kept coming over and over trying to hold Todd Bodine off. And Todd wasn't having any of it. I don't think TJ's too happy.
Both ends of that Red Horse Racing Toyota. Here's Todd. Go up through the gears, gets down to the inside, and just TJ was kind of moving his way over there, and Todd made contact just about before it was time to get down on the brakes.
That was a big crash here at Martinsville. You don't tear one up much worse than that here.
Slammed into the inside wall, and then kicked it back out to the outside wall, and you see frustration. There is TJ Bell climbs out of his Red Horse Racing number 11.
That's the second truck we've seen make contact with the inside wall. Remember, Colin Brown early in the race made contact with the inside wall just about the same place that TJ did.
You know, you start cutting people off early in the race and you get by with it sometimes. But as it winds down, you get within 40 laps like we are now, you're not going to have a whole lot of patience because track position is so important and it's so tough to pass. Todd made a great restart, got on the inside of TJ, and decided he was going to stay there.
So TJ's all right. TJ had to climb into the ambulance.
He came into this race eighth in points. He's had a great start to the 2009 season. Three top 12 finishes so far.
He's going to climb into the ambulance now, but not happy at all with the 30 of Todd Bodine. Camping World Truck Series Racing on Speed is sponsored by Camping World, the official RV and outdoor retailer of NASCAR. By Subway, the big event is back. Any regular footlong for just $5. Subway, eat fresh. By Toyota, moving forward. And by Budweiser, reach for the perfect balance of flavor and refreshment. Budweiser, the great American lager. You want to call it lager?
I would.
Okay.
I think.
We can go either direction.
Okay.
Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick, 1 and 2. They talked about fuel being an issue early on. As we've continued to run these caution laps, they're starting to throw that out the window.
Yeah, we've been eavesdropping on Kevin Harvick's radio communication, and they think they're pretty good shape right now. They're not sure about the 51, although the 51 thinks they're okay.
Can Kevin Harvick learn anything from yesterday's race as far as how you move somebody out of the way? Let's take a look.
Yesterday was awesome.
Yeah. Jimmy gets to the inside. He makes a little bit of contact. Both those guys did a great job saving those cars. Fortunately, they had enough of a cushion on Tony Stewart, who was running third, to both emerge in front of Tony. And
how big do you think Tony was smiling when he watched those two go down to turn three like that?
I saw his interview on Fox after the race, and he said he was hoping they were going to get together. He just wasn't close enough to do anything with it.
I bet you there was a second time there he said, yes, that's what I'm talking about. What a great job by both those guys, though. Not only Denny Hamlin for hanging on to his car, but Jimmy Johnson got down on the curb trying to stay off of Denny and had to miss Denny and the curb, or tried to miss Denny. He didn't quite pull that off. But hung on to his car, kept it heading in the right direction.
30 laps to go when they get to the start-finish line. It's Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick, Ron Hornaday, and Mike Skinner, your top four. Green back in the air.
Poor start for David Starr on the inside. That allows all these lead lap trucks to get going. Ooh, a little contact. Skinner got in the back of Hornaday.
Hornaday had to check up a little bit. Kevin Harvick didn't get as good a restart as Ron Hornaday did.
Nobody ever gets as good a restart as Ron Hornaday does.
Kyle Busch with a great lead as he had a shot out of the hole there.
Harvick's regrouped, though. Now he can set his sights on that 51 truck. We do think that these trucks can make it on gas, so it's just going to be a sprint to the end.
And right now, these guys are wanting some green flag racing, too. Kevin Harvick doesn't want to see these caution flags. He wants to let this race play out here, see if he has a better truck, and see if he can do something with Kyle Busch.
29 right into the back of Todd Bodine earlier, just a half a lap ago.
Good job saving it by Todd, and you can see
look at three wide up top left of your screen.
Look at the 29. Wham.
Somebody's going to have to give up there. You can't run three wide at Martinsville.
They worked it out, though, Rick.
Look at Hermie on the inside
wide.
Making it through.
Ooh. Hermie Sadler moves to the inside. It was four wide coming out of turn number four.
Hermie slid that truck up into the 15th spot with that move, so he's not only getting aggressive, he's making it count.
Yeah, nice steady run for Hermie in that TNT Chevrolet.
That's awesome, 15th place right now. Quietly been working his way toward the front.
Oh, a little contact there. Kevin Harvick into the back of the 51 of Kyle Busch for the lead.
Kevin knows time is running out, 26 laps to go. We never know if you can count on any caution laps. Kevin said, if I can do it, now's the time.
Kyle Busch trying to run consistent lap times.
He better
Hornaday, I believe Harvick believes he needs to get around Kyle in a hurry because that truck behind him, as they run four, five, six, eight laps, Hornaday begins to catch these two. So he needs to get around Kyle Busch right now. Hopefully that'll be a pick on Hornaday to keep Hornaday from getting to Harvick.
I think Kevin can reasonably expect Ron Hornaday not to rough him up any.
Well, we would hope that would be the fact. Kyle Busch still trying to hold off Kevin Harvick. Harvick looks like the fast truck on the racetrack, though. He stays all over the back bumper, that 51 of Kyle Busch.
Running fast, fast laps. Kevin Harvick just three laps ago bettered his fastest lap of the race.
Isn't this the time of day when you want your truck at its best? And Kevin Harvick has that right now. Right in the back of Kyle Busch. Going to make a move on the inside on the front straightaway.
Looks to the inside. They cross the start-finish line. Kyle Busch moves up the racetrack. Gives him a little room. Kevin Harvick takes it. They're door-to-door as they go down the backstretch.
Slight contact right there. Kevin's going to try to get down into three inside him.
There he goes again. Let's see if Hornaday will stay behind that two and take advantage of this pass. Kevin Harvick not able to get by the 51.
Kyle Busch left Harvick enough room to get his truck in there, but he didn't leave him enough room to operate it the way he needed to. He pinched Harvick off coming off the turn, and Kevin couldn't get the gas down. Kyle retained the lead. What a great job by Kyle Busch.
Well, got a good run off the corner there off of four.
And all of this as it's going on, the five of Mike Skinner has tucked to the back of Ron Hornaday now.
Boy, this is great truck series racing right here. We're inside of 20 laps to go, and you have four truck lengths apart.
Yeah, and it's real comforting for Kevin Harvick right now. He knows he's faster than the 51, and like you said, he can reasonably trust that he's not going to get hit from behind as he tries to get around the 51 truck. If that was Mike Skinner behind him, he would have problems in front of him and behind him.
So again, Harvick all over the back bumper of the 51. We've seen Kyle Busch move up the racetrack. He gave Kevin Harvick the line. And Kevin Harvick wasn't able to complete the pass, and so Kyle Busch back out front, looking to make it three in a row in the Camping World Truck Series as far as wins.
We know that Kyle Busch is not going to run all the races this year. He's here to win races. That truck right there, Kevin Harvick's, it's not a full-time truck either. He's here just to win this race.
And right behind them, that 33 of Ron Hornaday, he's here to win a championship.
He's got a guy behind him that's thinking the same thing in the five truck of Mike Skinner. He's got a new team and a lot of optimism. I like the way Mike Skinner's brain's working right now. He thinks he's got the team to win this championship with.
Now some lap trucks are going to come into play here. There's the 50 set of Norm Benning. And then one of Kevin Harvick's drivers, Ricky Carmichael in the fourth, moving way out of the way.
You see the blue with the yellow stripe through it. That's to let these lap trucks know that they need to move over. The leaders are coming by.
See Ricky Carmichael, that's a bad day at Martinsville when your truck looks like that.
Kyle Busch had about a truck length and a half on Kevin Harvick. And now that has disappeared. Harvick all over the back bumper once again. Hornaday still a truck length back from Harvick.
I think Harvick felt like he had the best truck in Atlanta a couple of weeks ago when that 51 beat him.
Yeah.
He'd like to return the favor here.
Second or third gear. So Kevin Harvick still tucked to the back bumper, that 51. He's tested the waters. He knows he can get to the inside of him.
He might, when he slides down on the inside of him the next time, have to move him up a little bit. Scoot Kyle Busch over so he can get a little operating room exiting the turn.
Right now, Kyle Busch has not made one mistake. If he makes a mistake, Kevin Harvick will pounce on it. He hasn't done it. He gave Kevin room when Kevin had a run at him, but then beat him up off the corner on the high side.
13 laps of racing to go. They race down the backstretch, still bumper to bumper.
Kevin knows if he roughs up Kyle, he better get away from him in a hurry, too, because if you rough somebody up, they're going to get you back. And sometimes the guy with the last say
wins.
He wins the argument.
That's Brett Butler in the 47. He's lap down truck. He moved to the outside so these guys can continue to race on the inside of the track.
Brett's done a good job learning his truck today and staying out of the leader's way. That was another example of that. Harvick's trying to be the quicker picker-upper, get down in the corner, and get on the gas in that Bounty truck and pick her up.
11 laps remaining as we close in on the final 10 laps.
You think Kyle Busch is thinking, okay, when are you going to hit me?
I know you're good. I think it's in the back of his mind.
There's contact there. He moves to the inside. They go down the front stretch. Kevin Harvick's got the bumper to the inside of that 51.
Kyle's going to give him room again. Not a whole lot of room, but some room.
Enough this time. Harvick got his nose out in front. That means when he gets down to turns 3 and 4, can he nose ahead, slide up the hill a little bit?
Here comes the 33. Kevin Harvick trying to get by that 51. Harvick is going to lead that lap as they go across the start-finish line and into one. 9 laps of racing to go.
Kyle got a little bit loose off of four, never backed off. It looks like Kevin's got him cleared. Oh, contact.
Little contact between the 51 and the 33, and now smoke coming out of the back of the 51. A little bit of sheet metal contact with the tires.
Yeah, that's when Kevin got into the back of him just a little bit, and I think that's caused that tire to rub.
I think Bush's goose is cooked. I think that rub and with Hornaday all over the back of him.
Now Kevin Harvick.
Check up.
Check out. And oh, the caution comes out. The 48. The 84 get turned around. And so Hermie Sadler having a great run here gets spun around in the wrong direction. 13th caution of the day.
Jason White went down pit road with his hood up. You see it has all over the windshield there.
17 also had to come onto pit road while all of that great racing was going on up front for the lead.
Was that a gas issue for the 17?
We believe he ran out of fuel.
Could that be
a similar situation?
Sign of things to
a
come?
Precursor? Yeah. A precursor, maybe?
We've seen that before. When one guy has problems, sometimes others do as well. Looks like on about lap 94.
I'm showing my records that he pitted the same time the two of Kevin Harvick did.
The plot thickens.
Kevin Harvick up front. Take a look. Hermie Sadler was up on the curb there a bit. 48. Johnny Sauter has to get turned around.
Remember, see the left rear quarter panel. There's the contact right there that got that fender in the tire, but that's what allowed Kevin to get to the inside of the 51 and eventually take the pass for the lead.
Gentle contact. Almost where Kyle wasn't sure he was even getting hit, I think.
Well, all eyes are on the 2 and 51 now. 51 drops back to second. Krista.
Where's the 51 out of gas?
No, actually, you saw on the front stretch, he laid back a little bit so the team could check the left rear damage, the tire smoke there coming from a tire rub, and they just told him, Kyle, we have the binoculars out. As you saw there on the pit box, you have cords showing.
I believe he went over the commitment line.
He was on the commitment line on the backstretch.
I think he was, too.
He's trying to scrub the wall maybe with that fender to squish it in. Yeah. But I think he went over the white line. You can't cross that white line.
And not go onto pit road. He had all four tires on the commitment line and then went back out on the racetrack.
Yeah, I think that may result in a penalty from NASCAR.
Yeah, you got to come to pit road once you cross the commitment line. That white line is the commitment line. The yellow one is the speed line.
Right.
And he's going to plead his case that he had no intentions of coming to pit road. He was just trying to get that quarter panel up off the fender. We'll see if he wins that argument or not.
We're hearing from NASCAR, commitment line violation for the 51 truck. Violation.
Yeah, he needs to get to pit road right away.
Can't drag the side of my truck on the side of the wall.
That's his argument.
But the rule's a rule. The line's there.
He needed to get away from the wall and not go across that line.
He could have done that on the front stretch and it'd been no penalty.
What he needs to do now is get to pit road, get some left side tires. He's going to be in the back. I'd get some tires right quick.
Absolutely,
Bill.
Yeah. You never know how many positions you may gain here on this little shootout we're going to have.
Yeah, get me four tires.
We got to go to the back or not, Jeff?
Yes. We're coming this time.
They're going to come in, pull the fender
away.
Put
four on it. Come on.
Yeah, put four on it. That's the call.
There, George making the call there for Kyle Busch. So it will not be three in a row for Kyle Busch in 2009 in the Camping World Truck Series as he will make his way onto pit road. Kevin Harvick now looking for another win in the Camping World Truck Series.
Got his teammate behind him.
Great this run would be for Mike Skinner in third as well.
Yeah, this will be the first time if Kevin Harvick's able to hold on. This is the first time he's ever won a truck race outside of the state of Arizona and the city of Phoenix. Chris Devoto.
Kyle Busch coming in. They just made the call. It's now going to be just a two-tire stop, left sides only. Kyle Busch extremely frustrated, extremely angry on the radio. Left sides only because this thing is about to go green.
They had plenty of time to put four tires on because he's got to go to the back.
Well, they also had to worry about clearing that left rear quarter panel from the tire, too, so they didn't really know how much time that was going to take.
Yeah.
And now they're waving off. They're waving off the green, so Kyle may come right back in to put right side tires on. Krista?
That is exactly right. They just said, come back in. We're going to put on right sides, and the quote was, we're not going to give this to him.
Well, there you go.
I don't understand.
I'm not sure who they're not going to give it to because they're going to start in the back, and I don't know if they'll have anything for somebody up front. Krista.
I didn't understand either, but I think what he means is they're not going to give it without a fight. He's going to make this a shootout. He doesn't have many laps, but he is going to try to pick off every race truck he can. I don't know if that's a good explanation, Michael, but it's an explanation, right?
Well, it's the heat of the battle. You know, you want to make sure you get all you can get, but there's only two laps left.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a single file restart.
And
if he's at the back.
He's going to be at the very back. But, hey, that's what we would have done. We'd have come in and put four tires on. And if you can get one spot, two, three, four, whatever you can get, because he's a competitor. And all those guys on that pit crew, Doug George and J.R. Norris, all those guys are competitors.
The interesting situation now in front of us. Kevin Harvick, team owner for the 33 of Ron Hornaday. It is the green-white checker for the Camping World Truck Series. Kevin Harvick, Ron Hornaday, Mike Skinner, green flag back in the air.
That may be the best restart anybody has ever gotten on Ron Hornaday right there. Great job by Kevin Harvick on this restart.
You think maybe that could have been choreographed a little bit? Harvick get squared away from Hornaday, giving him a bit of a cushion, knowing that Hornaday could then run back up to Harvick and then distance himself from Skinner.
Trouble.
Problems on the back stretch, and into turn three and four, we stay green, and now the caution comes out. That will mean Kevin Harvick will win at Martinsville. Kevin Harvick grabbing his fourth career win, and again, as I mentioned, this is the first time he's won outside of Phoenix.
What a great job. Brand new truck that Ernie Cope and Kevin's guys brought to this racetrack. Got Bounty to sponsor it. What a super job by Kevin. Good pit strategy. Pitted on lap number 94 for fuel. They pitted. We're getting a report they did not take the white flags.
Well, I'm wondering what the, as far as,
then that,
as,
that
far
what?
As the prescribed distance, that wasn't the green-white checkered then because we just completed lap 251.
But they took the green flag on 49. They didn't take the white on 49. So I don't know.
I think this is going to be an official race, right, the way they're running right now.
They're going to check scoring. NASCAR is taking care of that.
Yeah, we took the green with at 49, so that meant overtime was
because white would have been completed 250.
Right.
Yeah. And we're getting reports that is the race.
Yeah, you only have one shot at a green-white checkered finish, and they have made it official. Kevin Harvick is your winner today on the seldom used Monday Camping World Truck Series race.
See what happens here late in the going. Looks like the 16 of Brian Scott gets into the back of Terry Cook, and he gets into Todd Bodine, and it ends a really what looked to be a promising day for Todd.
Yeah. Frustrating, though. Obviously, they were working very hard at keeping sponsors on this truck and keeping them going. Whelan jumped on board for this race.
And Terry Cook had a great run going as well.
Awesome job, Ernie.
There you hear him, Ernie Cope, crew chief for Kevin Harvick for this race. Bringing the Bounty home into victory lane. The Bounty, the quicker picker-upper.
It's amazing the differing pit strategy. Kevin came to pit road on lap number 64, put tires on, came back on lap 94 to put fuel on. Remember, Ron Hornaday came back on lap 129 for tires, and they end up one truck link apart after 250 laps.
Kyle Busch climbing out of his truck, obviously disappointed, disgusted with the way this one ended.
So close to having victory.
I think he's mostly disappointed, I think, with the penalty.
Yeah, having when he was trying to just straighten the fender using the inside wall, and he did go across the commitment line, he's thinking, you know what, I wasn't pulling a fast one on anyone. But at the same time, the rule is the rule. You go across the commitment line, that means you are coming onto pit road. So Kyle Busch
just inside
jogging away from the racetrack.
10 laps to go, he had victory in sight. Running away with a 17th place finish has got to be very, very.
disappointing.
Yeah, he's getting ready to cross over the racetrack and head on home. Tough, what a great job by Kyle and all his guys, and just a tough break. And you know, had it not been for that penalty, it would have been a good shot. He'd a good chance. He'd have probably ended up this race in second position. Certainly not if second, third.
Well, Kyle Busch doesn't want to stick around for the celebration that Kevin Harvick will be experiencing on Victory Lane. We'll be back to hear from our winner, Kevin Harvick, right here on Speed. The Camping World Truck Series lives on Speed. Welcome back to Martinsville Speedway. Let's head right down to Victory Lane with Chris Devoto.
And here comes our winner. Everyone goes to the office on Mondays. Well, the Truck Series was in its office, and Kevin Harvick was most definitely the employee of the day on a Monday. Well, I don't know really where to start. Let's start, I guess, with the finish. That was a little crazy at the end.
Yeah, it was, you know, everybody was trying to save gas. But the first thing I want to do is thank Kroger and Bounty. They put this deal together on Monday, and it's a pretty cool looking truck. And I also want to thank the guys at the shop. The guys in the fab shop built this truck in about 10 days. Triad Chassis for building this truck in about 6 days. Brand new truck. But man, that was fun. Got to push and shove a little bit. And me and Kyle raced hard there at the end. I didn't know if any of us were going to make it on gas. But good day for KHI and Hornaday and his Longhorn truck. And Ricky got his first laps here. So it was a wide gamut of things, but still a great day to be here in Victory Lane, so close to home.
You told us the other day you were just kind of the guinea pig. You just experiment sometimes with these trucks, and here you are in Victory Lane.
Yeah, well, you know, they make me do all the R&D stuff with the trucks, and you know, it's just one of those deals where we had a lot of different things in this thing to try for all of our new stuff coming out, and it all works. So the other thing I want to do is thank the fans. Coming here on a Monday, what a crowd for a Monday afternoon in Martinsville, and just a lot of fun.
They put this deal together on a Monday, and they win on a Monday. Adam Alexander is standing by with the winner's teammate.
Yeah, Ron Hornaday, a great run from the back after an issue getting onto pit road. You rallied to finish in the top five, second, in fact. Talk about it.
Well, I didn't know the pit or not the pit, but the guy's done a great job again. It's just, you know, we needed fuel, and I just don't know how the 51 was going to do it again. And Kevin, you know, he pitted before us. So Mark Smith does a great job on the motor. We tried a little different carburetor strategy, and it seemed to work. You know, this truck is the one I wrecked at Phoenix, and I got to thank Longhorn and Chevrolet and everybody what they've done. I mean, it's pretty cool to come back. I mean, we had a pretty good truck, and I used it up a little bit to get back through there. And then when I watched Kyle and Kevin sit there running pretty hard, I figured I'd just save it. And then Skinner started catching me, and I ran it back up on him. But second, darn. I mean, I was too worried about Skinner on the restart, and I laid back too far and let Kevin get away. But I might have had to move him the last lap if it stayed green going in there, going for the white. But if you guys haven't driven a GM lately, get to your local store. They're a lot of fun to drive.
Go congratulate the boss.
I'm good. Thank you.
Let's take a look again at the pass for the lead. Again, Kyle Busch was running out front. Here comes Kevin. He had to use the chrome horn just to move him up the racetrack.
Slight contact. Now he's on the inside. Kyle gives him room when they get down to turn number one.
That slight contact cost Kyle Busch the second spot too, because he had to come to pit road eventually and get that fender pulled away from his tire. So even though it was slight, it was very costly.
Here are unofficial results. Kevin Harvick winning it at Martinsville. It's his fourth career win in the Camping World Truck Series and the first one away from Phoenix. So he knows how to win on a short track.
How about our pole sitter, Rick Crawford, is going to battle back to a fifth place finish. Stacy Compton with a great run in sixth, and Brian Scott with an eighth place finish here at Martinsville.
Brian always seems to be competitive and runs really well. I'm really, really proud of the job he's been doing. Mikey Kyle, that's a fun name to say, first of all. Mikey Kyle.
And finished 12th.
Got
good
up
run
in the 12th spot.
And that's Brad Keselowski's truck that he was driving.
Timothy Peters ran in the top 10 all day long, ran out of gas, had to pit. Back in the 22nd spot.
Next week, NASCAR moves to Texas, and our coverage again begins on Friday. It's got Sprint Cup Series practice on Speed, and then qualifying will be on Speed as well. Saturday, it's two sessions of Sprint Cup Series practice, both on Speed, and then Sunday. It begins with NASCAR Race Day on Speed, and then Sprint Cup Series racing on Fox, followed by NASCAR Victory Lane, right back here on Speed. So our coverage of NASCAR continues next weekend across the Fox networks. Kevin Harvick,
KHI's
doing more interviews.
Big couple weeks. He got a win in his own Nationwide Series car over at Bristol, and now wins on a Monday here at Martinsville.
And remember, we talked about the differing pit strategies. We had two complete different pit strategies. Finish 1-2, and Kyle Busch, that would have been in the top three, he had yet another pit strategy.
And you knew it had to be that way. Walking around the pits, no one knew what they were going to do. Everybody did something different. In the end, it didn't really seem to make a whole lot of difference how you went about it.
Well, I want to thank everyone who stuck around, all the crew, the camera operators, and everybody in the truck for this Monday edition of the Camping World Truck Series.